And presenting the Pannill Sweatshirts 500 from Martinsville, Virginia. The cars begin to warm their engines here on the front stretch. And in just a few moments, they'll be moving out and beginning this 500-lap contest. In-car cameras today with Harry Gant and with Michael Waltrip as he gets adjusted in the seat and ready to pull away from the grid. And the balloons rise overhead as the Pannill Sweatshirts people have provided some spectacular setting for this Winston Cup event. Jeff Bodine set to go from the pole position, and he is driving that Chevy Monte Carlo the final time that race car will compete. And there you can see the record since 1983. It has won more than 50% of the races that it has been in. 32 cars and drivers are set to go now, and here is the starting lineup for today's race. On the pole position with a new track record of 93.097 miles an hour in the Levi Garrett Chevrolet, number 5, Jeff Bodine. Outside will be Alan Kowicki from Greenfield, Wisconsin, and the number 7, Xerox Antifreeze for Thunderbird. The second row is Mark Martin in the Strolite Ford, number 6, Mark's from Batesville, Arkansas. And Terry Labonte starts alongside in the outside of the second row. The number 11, Budweiser for Terry, is from Corpus Christi, Texas. Going to row number 3, it's Ken Schrader from Fenton, Missouri, driving the Folgers Coffee Chevrolet, car number 25. And then Greg Sachs from Matatuck, New York, in the Crisco Pontiac, the car number is 88. Going to row number 4 now, on the inside will be the number 3 GM Goodwin Chevrolet, driven by Dale Earnhardt from Kannapolis, North Carolina. Starting in 8th position from Bartow, Florida, Rick Wilson in the Kodak Film Oldsmobile, car number 4. In the 5th row for today's race is Rusty Wallace from St. Louis, Missouri, driving the number 27 Kodiak Pontiac. And starting in 10th position, outside row number 5, will be Darrell Waltrip from Franklin, Tennessee. He'll drive the number 17 Tide Chevrolet. In the 6th row will be one of the 6 rookies in the field, Larry Pearson from Spartanburg, South Carolina, in the number 16 Chattanooga Chew Buick. Flanking him in row number 6, the number 30 car, Country Time Lemonade Pontiac, driven by Michael Waltrip from Owensboro, Kentucky. In the 7th row, another rookie, Dick Trickle, in fact the leader in rookie points now. He'll drive the number 84 Miller High Life Buick. He's from Wisconsin Rapids, Wisconsin. And outside of row number 7 will be Phil Parsons from Detroit, Michigan, in the Crown Petroleum Oldsmobile, car number 55. In the 8th row, Brett Bodine drives the Budmore Motorcraft Ford, car number 15. Brett hails from Chemung, New York. And starting in the 16th position, Harry Gant from Taylorsville, North Carolina, in the number 33 Skoll Oldsmobile. In the 9th row, the King, Richard Petty, driving the SDP Pontiac, car number 43, and then Bobby Hillen Jr. outside of row number 9. As we take a look at the rest of the starting lineup for today's race, you'll notice that Bill Elliott is outside of row number 12. Not a very good starting performance for him. He'll be trying to work his way through the field rapidly. There are 500 laps of competition here, but it is costly to lose a lap. And there you see the final row, Ernie Irvin and Ben Hess. The crew cam actually becomes an official cam, if you will, for today's race. It's being worn by Jimmy Cox, who is the sign man of NASCAR, positioned at the end of pit road. Now, he is the one that holds the sign that tells the drivers when to stop and go as they exit the pits. It should be an exciting shot that he'll give us as the cars pull out from their assigned positions in the pit area. Michael Waltrip carries one of our in-car cameras in the Country Time Lemonade Pontiac, and also Harry Gant will carry one of our in-car cameras, and we have a third operational for you today. That will be the Ricky Rudd Quaker Steak Buick, also carrying one of our in-car cameras. And there is Bill Elliott alongside of Ricky Rudd back there in that 12th and 13th row. Bill Elliott trying to work his way through the point standings and defend his championship in the Winston Cup competition. So we're set to go now for 500 laps here at Martinsville in what is always an exciting afternoon of Winston Cup racing. Here comes the field down for the start. Jeff Bodine in the Monte Carlo crosses the line first, and the green flag is out. We are racing. Bodine leads Alan Kowicki and Mark Martin down the backstretch into turn 3 as one lap is about to be completed.
said Bill Elliott was starting outside the 12th row. And outside is the key word, because anytime these drivers get on the outside today, they've got problems. The first five or six, they will see Harry again on the outside, and they're just going to continue backwards until they can finally get down to the inside of the racetrack. Harry trying to get by Richard Petty, but no, Richard's going to go back by him down the back straightaway.
It's pretty much single file formation except for Gant, who is caught on the outside, and Bill Elliott, who is also hung out to dry a little bit behind the Harry Gant and Richard Petty situation.
Not very many friendships out there right now. Everybody wants that inside groove, and if you get hung out there like Harry Gant is, there's not a whole lot you can do, but he has moved up around Richard Petty now, trying to move on the outside of Brett Bodine, but he has an opportunity to get back in, but he's not going to take it. He's going to try to stay out there.
He indeed is staying on the high side of Brett Bodine in the third and fourth turns. Now he comes down the straightaway and falls in behind Brett, so he will now have that inside line or wherever he wants to be.
Brett Sack started in the sixth position, third row outside. He is already back to 11th. He's one of those drivers that got hung out on the outside and just simply couldn't do anything about it. Now here's Gant. He didn't take advantage of that position he had down on the inside a moment ago. Might have cost him.
Well, we've watched Harry Gant over the years. You say, well, some fans might be saying, well, Harry Gant likes to run on the outside. He set his car to run up there. No, folks, he didn't set his car to run up there. He needs to get to the inside.
Having difficulty doing it now, Richard Petty passes him. And Harry, I believe now, although the number 21 car of Neil Bonnet is right behind him, now Harry will slide down into that inside groove.
Yeah, I believe he might stay there for a little bit now and see if he can make the pass on the inside. But as you can see, there is no room whatsoever on the inside.
And that yellow curb there that you saw on the inside of the racetrack is a very important one. It's only about 4.5 inches high, but I tell you, it presents some problems for the drivers. Fifth and sixth position as the number 25 car of Kent Schrader, which had an outstanding qualifying performance, one of his best of the year since Daytona, and the number 3 car of the defending champion of this race, Dale Earnhardt. The number 27 car also in the battle here. He's behind Dale Earnhardt. Then comes Rick Wilson in the yellow number 4 car and Darrell Waltrip in 17.
It's single file competition right now, and that's not unexpected. As the race goes on a little bit, that groove will move up a little, but still the inside groove will be the place to be most of the day.
That's Terry Labonte there in car number 11. That is running right ahead of Ken Schrader. Schrader a little bit sideways, maybe, coming out of the fourth corner. It is Terry Labonte who has the fourth position nailed down, and then Schrader and Earnhardt.
I think outside is the key word again. Ken Schrader came off the corner, got out just a little bit wide when he tried to bring the car back down the groove. The back end did slip just a little bit, and we saw that.
And there is the pack of cars behind that first ring. That's Greg Saxon, number 88. Michael Waltrip in the number 30 car, and here's the view that he has of the Sachs car in front of him. Phil Parsons is right behind Michael Waltrip.
And the front pack has moved away from Greg Sachs by at least a second out there, so they're pretty bunched up behind him. You can see there how far ahead the front pack of cars are from Greg Sachs, so he has nothing but daylight in front of him.
Greg Sox, not a very good start. Here's Dick Trickle on the inside of Larry Pearson as the two top rookie candidates slug it out here in the early going at Martinsville. Trickle in the number 84 car and Pearson in the 16. Here comes Brett Bodine nosing his way into the scene, and Pearson is now hung on the outside.
And once he got out of that position, they're going to just keep on going by.
The view from Harry Gant's car as he is involved in this battle. Richard Petty there is ahead of the Chattanooga car driven by Pearson. Gant now has settled down into that inside groove.
Well, Larry Pearson saw just a little bit of an opening there behind Richard Petty, so he tucked back in behind Petty to move back to the inside. Look how close they come to that yellow curbing you were mentioning, Bob. You want to get as close to it as you possibly can, but you don't want to hit it because it can knock the front end out of alignment. And also it can upset the car and throw you high on the racetrack if you aren't careful. So it's a very fine line they're driving.
Look at the work that Harry Gant has to go through just in negotiating one lap. Look how close they come to that inside curbing. One of the things that Martinsville Speedway is known for.
And when you hit that inside curbing, Bob, it's going to upset the car, so you have to be very careful that you don't touch it.
And there you can see the interval that Jeff Bodine has opened up on Alan Kulwicki first and second position. Mark Martin is running third. And in fourth position is Terry Labonte. Fifth position at the moment is Ken Schrader. We'll be right back. Back at Martinsville, Virginia Speedway in the Pannill Sweatshirts 500 Winston Cup race. Jeff Bodine, the only driver to lead in every race this year, is not letting that streak get away from him. He is leading at the moment, having jumped out into the lead at the drop of the green flag from his pole position. Alan Kowicki is running second, and here is a group of cars headed by Michael Waltrip. The number 84 car of Dick Trickle is on the move, just passing the 55 of Phil Parsons. And there is the view from the back glass of the Country Time Lemonade Pontiac driven by Michael Waltrip. Looking back at Dick Trickle as Trickle tries to put the heat on Waltrip. Trickle, by the way, has moved up into 10th in Winston Cup points. And as I said earlier, he is now on top of the Winston Cup rookie point standings.
And he's also right on top of that 30 car. He is really wanting by. You don't run that close unless you have some serious intentions on getting by, because running that close, the car will overheat. There's just not enough air going through the grill.
Well, we watched that battle. We have a report that Davey Allison, who started in the 28th position, has dropped to the rear of the pack now. All the cars are still in the lead lap, but we understand that Davey has lost the cylinder, and he's running on 7 cylinders right now.
And there goes Dick Trickle. Oh, and Waltrip and Trickle have a meeting, and Trickle miraculously saves the car and maintains the position. He had just passed Michael Waltrip to gain the spot, and then was nudged by Michael Waltrip in some good close competition. So Dick Trickle now moves to 11th place.
And look, as quickly as he got, at how far he drove away, just 2 or 3 car lengths in one lap. Dick Trickle, a car to be reckoned with. He's on the move.
Well, he's adapted to this racetrack very well, as he has to all the other Winston Cup tracks he has been on.
It is indeed just amazing how well that Dick Trickle has performed in the races that he has been in this year, substituting for Mike Alexander, who was quoted as saying in the newspaper today that he is ready to come back soon, still under some rehabilitation from an accident he suffered in Florida late last year. Now, here is another group of cars, and three of the certainly the contenders in the Winston Cup points at the moment. That is Ken Schrader, Dale Earnhardt, Rusty Wallace, and Darrell Waltrip.
And they've really been having some good battles there, each of them trying to pass the other. And here's Rusty Wallace down on the inside trying to pass Earnhardt, and Darrell Waltrip trying to go by Rusty on the outside.
Let's see how Waltrip handles this situation. It appears as if he's going to cleanly pass. Indeed, he cleanly passes Rusty Wallace before getting the turn. So being on the outside certainly did not hurt Darrell Waltrip in that instance.
That's a mark of a good handling race car, Dennis.
That was impressive, folks. Darrell Waltrip may be a driver to be reckoned with before this day is over. That was impressive. And I tell you, these fans here jumped on their feet just a moment ago when we saw those three cars together.
Martinsville Speedway has undergone some renovation and some remodeling since we were here last fall, with a brand new tower and grandstand that we are atop of, and some improvements to this gorgeous facility in the southern part of Virginia. We're watching Earnhardt in sixth position and Waltrip in seventh, and then Rusty Wallace running in eighth spot. As the lead continues to be held by Jeff Bodine a few feet ahead of this group, as Bodine now begins to close in on some of the slower traffic. The number 11 car of Labonte is leading this contingent down the straightaway. Behind him is Schrader and the others.
Earnhardt's car is not sticking on the bottom of the racetrack like I would think that the car should. He's going up a little bit, about a half lane, and that's taking the outside groove away from Darrell, but he keeps looking on the inside like he is right now.
Oh, here
he
comes Waltrip.
This time.
Yes, he moves inside of Earnhardt, who takes the high road, and let's see if Darrell can, yes, indeed. It looks, well, they go into the corner pretty much side by side, as Dale is not willing to give up that spot, but now as they come out of the corner, Darrell Waltrip picks up another position and is on the move.
And right in front of them, Kenny Schrader is up beside of Terry Labonte. You can see that side-by-side battle as Darrell Waltrip moves up on it. Here's Rusty Wallace moving on the inside of Dale Earnhardt. So some passing now beginning to happen.
Well, wow. This is 4th, 5th, 6th, 7th, and 8th right here. Wallace to the inside of Earnhardt as he begins to slip a little. As
I mentioned just a moment ago, Earnhardt unable to keep the car right on the bottom of the racetrack. And particularly this early in the race, that's where you have to be. Boy, don't you know Darrell's jumping at the bit right now because those two cars in front running side by side.
But it did give him an opportunity when Schrader moved by Terry Labonte to move up on the inside of it. Now Darrell will be able to make that pass himself.
They've got Labonte on the outside. Here comes Waltrip to the inside as Schrader gets a little high coming out of the corner. And Darrell has to back off just a little bit because of Ben Hess, the number 40 car, one of the back markers that was in the way temporarily there. So up front, while the action is settling down somewhat there, it is Jeff Bodine in the lead, but look who he is about to lap. Davey Allison, who has struggled all weekend, beginning this race from the 28th starting position, and now stands to go a lap down here momentarily. In fact, he'll pull to the low side of the racetrack at the end of the backstretch, and Jeff Bodine moves alongside.
Jeff Bodine is coming into some very heavy traffic there. He's been out front there all along, but Bill Elliott's not too far up in front of him. In fact, he will be the next car that Jeff Bodine will lap. And here comes Alan Kulwicki following Bodine through the traffic.
Kulwicki is in second position in that number 7 car. And now we're watching Jeff Bodine try to put a lap on Bill Elliott. The number 90 car there is driven by Chad Little. Here they come down the straightaway, and it's two abreast down the straightaway, so Bodine is going to have to stay there at the moment. Now he follows Bill Elliott into the corner, putting Chad Little on the high side.
But he also put Alan Kulwicki, the second place car, right on the rear bumper of Jeff Bodine.
Well, Kulwicki, and here is a battle now as the number 27 car of Rusty Wallace begins to move. Inside, passing the 11 car of Terry Labonte, and here comes Earnhardt in the number 3 car.
But Terry Labonte's car is not working quite as well as it did earlier, and certainly not as well as he would like for it to, slipping out a little bit in the turns. Even Earnhardt, who was slipping out earlier in the turns, is able to go by.
Rick Wilson joins the fight in car number 4. Meanwhile, it is Bodine that has been able to pass and lap Bill Elliott in the first 39 laps of this race. He had moved to 12th in the point standings after, of course, that broken wrist and some very disappointing performances in the first few races. He has moved up to 12th in the point standings, but it's going to be a long battle for him. Jerry Punch has more on this story as we have it crashed in turn number 4. Ernie Irvin in car number 2. Remember, he was the only starter on Hoosiers. Got up a little high in turn number 4, and NASCAR is continuing its policy of not throwing the yellow flag unless the car stops on the racetrack or there is a safety situation. And certainly in that case, there was not. The green stays out, and no caution flag on the track. Irvin does go into the pits on the backstretch.
And there was no damage to the automobile. I looked as the car went by. We see Darrell Waltrip going by into third spot right now. So Darrell Waltrip definitely on the move, but I looked at Ernie's car as it went by. It was simply a flat tire, no wall contact at all.
Jack Arute has more from the pit area on why no yellow in that particular instance, Jack.
Well, Bobby, as you recall, at North Wilkesboro, there weren't as many yellows as there were at Bristol, and in the drivers' meeting, they announced to all the drivers that by keeping the yellows at a minimum for small incidents like tires going down, they were able to save the teams almost $32,000 in tires. So they let all of the teams know in the drivers' meeting that they were going to adhere to that policy here at Martinsville as well.
All right, Jack, and some great competition on the track continuing as the number 6 car of Mark Martin is in the high groove. He's been passed by Ken Schrader, and now the 27 car of Rusty Wallace also passes. So now Schrader moves up into 4th, Wallace to 5th, and Martin is back to 6th position. Jeff Bodine continues to lead the race, and behind him about 6 or 8 car lengths in 2nd position is Alan Kulwicki. We'll be back with more from Martinsville, Virginia after this. Bob Jenkins, Ned Jarrett, Benny Parsons, Jack Arute, and Dr. Jerry Punch back at Martinsville, Virginia Speedway in the Pannill Sweatshirts 500. Jeff Bodine, the Levi Garrett Chevrolet number 5, has the lead. The number 7 Xerox for Thunderbird of Alan Kulwicki running in 2nd spot as they are approaching now the number 83 car driven by Lake Speed attempting to put a lap on him. Several have gone a lap down already, including Davey Allison and also Bill Elliott, who has been lapped in the first 40 laps of this contest. Elliott continues to struggle. There he is on the outside of the racetrack. He and Davey now running together on the racetrack. Well, Dr. Jerry Punch, what has been the problem with Bill Elliott in the qualifying performance and obviously things not going his way here in the first stages of this race?
Well, Bob, of course, Bill Elliott did not make the field on the first day of qualifying. They were quite disappointed, but not surprised. The car he is driving here is the same car that he had trouble with last week at Wilkesboro. In fact, after the race at Wilkesboro, they sent the car down to Baggio Matthews' shop, and the car was basically sawed in half. They cut the front off, they cut the back off, and all they had was the roll cage and the driver's compartment left. They worked on the car all week long, had to rebuild the car, burn the midnight oil, and the Coors crew here now shaking their heads. They don't know what's wrong. They've tried to get the car running better, but they've already lost one lap here in the first 40 at Martinsville. Bob?
Well, we will probably expect some better things in 2 weeks from today when we are at Talladega, Alabama on the Super Speedway, where Elliott is among the better competitors on that racetrack.
Yeah, I think everybody figures that's when he's going to get back on track with his program, when he gets on the super speedways, and now that his wrist has pretty well healed, and maybe they're beginning to get caught up a little bit as far as their equipment's concerned. So I think we'll see Bill Elliott running stronger from here on out after today.
So Elliott back in 28th position as Jeff Bodine from Chemung, New York, has the lead. And there is the interval between first and second position. Alan Kowicki has been able to stay pretty close to him. And the number four car of Rick Wilson leads a group of others down the back stretch. Behind him is the 88 car of Greg Sachs and the 84 of Dick Trickle. This is 8th, 9th, and 10th.
You know, we noticed Greg Sachs had dropped back at the beginning of the race. He has caught back up to those cars that were running up in front of him. In fact, he's passed a few of them. Car might have been a little bit tight to begin with, but the track is coming to him, and the Frisco Pontiac is running good right now as he tries to move around Rick Wilson in the Kodak Film Oldsmobile.
He started 6th, dropped back to 11th just a few laps into the event, and now has worked his way back up to 9th position. Darrell Waltrip, meanwhile, is in 3rd spot as he has moved up from his 10th starting position and really has been one of the fastest cars on the racetrack.
Yes, he likes this racetrack. He has 9 wins here, and it is one of his favorites.
It has been impressive, starting 10th and moving up. And we've talked about it, it's a difficult racetrack to pass on. And Darrell is making it look easy.
And there are the leaders.
And Darrell Waltrip is gaining on the leaders. A while back, he was about a straightaway behind Jeff Bodine and Alan Kowicki in the car number 7 as they just put a lap on Morgan Shepherd in the Valvoline Pontiac car number 75. But Darrell Waltrip is definitely gaining on the front runners. Another driver that's running good is Ricky Rudd. As we look out the front windshield of his car, he has caught Neil Bonnie. Rick is starting back in the 25th position, and he now has moved up to about 16th or 20th it is. So he has picked off several positions, but he's, you can see the pack of cars that he's running and trying to move on the inside of Neil Bonnie now.
I talked to Ricky Rudd earlier. He's a little bit confused here because this is the car that he set on the pole with last fall. And he brought the same car back and almost won the race. He brought the same car back, and as Ned said, qualified 26th. So they're kind of scratching their head now, trying to figure this deal out.
But you know, it doesn't take much in terms of time to find yourself back in the pack here at Martinsville. The entire 30-car starting field, not considering the two provisional starters, were separated by .633, just a little more than half a second. And a race for second position is developing here as now Darrell Waltrip in the 17 car has caught Alan Kowicki and may be in a position to make a move here shortly. They come off of corner 4. Kowicki and Waltrip going for second.
Waltrip has just picked them off one at a time. Doesn't look like he escaped that Chevrolet too much as it came up through the pack. The car is just handling so well, and certainly he has the horsepower on the straightaway too.
Two of the first three are Chevy Monte Carlos. The middle car, second place, belongs to Alan Kowicki, but certainly Chevrolet would like to end the reign of the Monte Carlo with a victory here this afternoon. It'll be the Lumina at Talladega in 2 weeks.
And you talked about the Chevrolet. All three of the first three of the four Three of the first four cars are Chevrolets, and all three are owned by Hendrick Motorsports out of Charlotte, North Carolina, who was such a dominant force in the Daytona 500. Looks like Daytona and Martinsville, Rick, you got them figured out.
Now let's see if Walter can get his nose to the inside of Kulwicki. Kulwicki pulling away a little bit, coming off the second corner, and for the moment, Darrell Waltrip stays in that second spot as the leader begins to work some of the slower traffic. Back in the pack we go for some more action. That is the number six car of Mark Martin, the four of Rick Wilson, the 88 of Greg Sachs, and the 84 of Dick Trickle. This is 7th, 8th, 9th, and 10th.
Mark Martin started in the third position, so he has dropped back a little bit, about to drop back another position as Rick Wilson makes the move on him.
Wilson and Martin go into the corner side by side, and look at this action. Three abreast as they cross the line, and it looks like Darrell Waltrip will move in to second spot.
DW has taken the position, and now look how close he is on Jeff Bodine. As Bodine gets into traffic, into turn three, you can see Darrell Waltrip has moved right up on his bumper almost.
Jeff Bodine lapping the number 90 car of Chad Little, as he now has a lot of race traffic to contend with ahead Dave Marcus and Bobby Hillen Jr. and Hutt Strickland. And we'll go back and take a look once again of how Darrell Waltrip was able to move into second.
Well, Kulwicki went just a little bit high as he attempted to move around Ernie Irvin. And of course, Waltrip just dipped on the inside, made it three abreast down the front straightaway, stayed in that position, and had the groove going into turn one.
Classic short track racing there, folks. Classic.
And now you can see how Jeff Bodine is going to have to worry about Waltrip. Look at Waltrip move in on the leader.
And look how smooth that car is coming off of the turn, too.
And staying right down neck to that curve, right against the yellow curve. Look at it, just follow that curve all the way around the corner. And folks, it's not easy to do. Believe me, I've tried for years, and it's not easy to do.
Once again, sneaking up on the rear of the Levi Garrett Chevrolet.
Gains just a little bit every lap. Now they're coming in on some more traffic. He'll try to take advantage of that traffic to move around Bodine like he did Alan Kulwicki.
We've completed 70 laps. Darrell Waltrip started 10th, moved to 8th at the end of 25 laps. At the end of 50 laps, he was 3rd. And at 69 laps, he was 2nd. A nice, steady move toward the front by Darrell Waltrip, the winner of this year's Daytona 500. In fact, a two-time winner this year on the Winston Cup circuit. We'll be right back. Jeff Bodine in car number 5 continues to lead this Pannill Sweatshirts 500 from Martinsville, Virginia. Second position, the number 17 tie car of Darrell Waltrip. The number 88 car of Greg Sachs involved in a battle with the 84 car of Dick Trickle.
They've been going at it pretty hot and heavy here for the last few laps. Sachs has been able to hold off Dick Trickle, but you can see how close he's running on him. Just waiting, and Sachs did slip a little bit there. Trickle tried to move the inside. Let's see if he goes into the turn. It might have made contact just a little bit. Now the back end slips out a little bit on Sachs' car, but still Trickle couldn't make the move.
In the 6 races this year that Dick Trickle has competed in, he has finished in the top 10 3 of those times. He was 3rd at Atlanta, 5th at Bristol, and 4th at North Wilkesboro.
There's been some impressive stories in 1989. And Rusty Wallace, a good story. Darrell Waltrip, a great story. But I think Dick Trickle is one of the finest stories to come out of the year. To take in, to come in some, and substitute for Mike Alexander, he has done a tremendous job in that car.
Meanwhile, Waltrip is still working on Jeff Bodine as the Rick Hendricks cars are 1st and 2nd. And Ken Schrader, the other Hendrick car, is also in the top 5. Waltrip right there on the back bumper of Bodine. As again, Bodine will be approaching some slower traffic here in the next few moments. Waltrip may go to the outside. At least he looks to the outside. Now we'll fall in behind Bodine again.
Bob, their tires have to be getting worn. They're running a fairly soft rubber compound here, although this track is not known for wearing tires out that much. But still, with the 18 cars breaking the track record, it was primarily due to the softer compound that Goodyear brought here. And they have been working so well. But these tires, they've punished them pretty good now for 80 laps. So they're bound to be getting worn a little bit.
Well, Dr. Jerry Punch is in the Darrell Waltrip pit. Jerry, as far as setting a car up here at Martinsville, is there a difference between how you set it up for qualifying and on race day?
Well, normally, Bob, there's quite a difference in what you set up for qualifying and race day. But with the experience of Jeff Hammond and Darrell Waltrip, Jeff, you guys have basically the same setup for qualifying and race, don't you?
Pretty much, Jerry. We decided we come up here and get ready to race. You know, we want to settle a pole, but at the same time, we knew we didn't have a lot of practice time. So we decided to come prepared to race, and it looks like it's proven to be pretty good so far.
Even on seven cylinders last week at Wilkes-Barre, you were able to run with the leaders. That had to give you a lot of confidence coming to a horsepower track like Martinsville.
Yes, it did. It was bad that we had the problem we had at Wilkes-Barre, but the car handled extremely well, and you know, Darrell drove his heart out, and the guys did a good job in the pits, and we were able to make a good finish out of it. But you know, we hope we come up here today and we don't have any problems, and we can be able to, you know, get back in form that we've been looking for on the short tracks for a long time. We've been really working hard on our program, and I believe it's starting to come around.
Well, Jeff Hammond talks about the pit stops. There may be a significant change in the pits today, gentlemen. In the NASCAR drivers' meeting, they have forbidden anyone to sling the jack around, a la Junior Johnson for so many years. That's who Jeff Hammond learned from. He is one of the best at slinging that jack from the right to the left side of the car, and that is strictly forbidden now on pit road, so it may have an effect on Walter's pit stops here today. Gentlemen?
And we'll be watching for that on the first series of pit stops in what was a two-car battle for the lead between Bodine and Waltrip. As we take a look at the field rundown, now has really become a five-car battle, at least a four-car battle, as Bodine, Waltrip, Kowicki, and Rusty Wallace are all right there together at the end of 75 laps. Well, this was the rundown.
Neil Bonnet was the car just at Jeff Bodine lap just a few moments ago. Well, naturally, he did not want to go a lap down. He held Jeff up just a little bit long enough for Kowicki and Rusty Wallace to get back in the race.
One thing I noticed, Benny, when Jeff Hammond was talking, when Bodine came up on Neil Bonnet, Neil was giving him running room. He went to the inside. That's what he was supposed to do, but Jeff couldn't go on the outside. That was the problem. He just simply couldn't get around. He's going to try to keep that car as low on that racetrack as he possibly can, because he knows how well Darrell Waltrip's car is working down on the inside.
Waltrip trying to get his nose under Bodine going into turn number one. It didn't work. They're single file through three and four, and now Waltrip looks to the outside as they exit the fourth corner, just perhaps trying to set Bodine up for a move. Single file formation, though. There are your first four, Bodine, Waltrip, Kowicki, and Rusty Wallace.
Tell you what, it's a little bit scary, Ned, because you're exactly right. Jeff's car is not working on the outside nearly as well as Darrell Waltrip's. So Darrell Waltrip, if he gets by Bodine, traffic is not going to be that big a problem for him. He's going to be able to motor by that traffic and just kill the competition, it looks like.
But he's in a position now that he can't try to pass Bodine on the outside, because if he does, Kowicki and Rusty Wallace are up close enough that they can take advantage of it if it doesn't work.
And there they are. And meanwhile, sneaking up on this four-car move for the lead is the number three car of Dale Earnhardt. So it's going to be a five-car battle here momentarily.
Yeah, I think Jeff Bodine's car has slowed down. He's actually holding them up a little bit. I think his tires are getting pretty well worn.
I think that's exactly right. Rusty Wallace looking on the inside of Kowicki. Kowicki said, nope, I got that spot, and I know better to get outside.
We've completed 89 out of 500 laps in the Pannill Sweatshirts 500 from Martinsville, Virginia. At the moment, it's Bodine having led all the way, but he's under great pressure from Waltrip and others. We'll be right back. Back at Martinsville, where the race continues under green, we have had no caution flag so far. We had one minor spin involving the number two car of Ernie Irvin down in the fourth corner. He continues, as a matter of fact, is there with the leaders at the moment as they lap him again. But no caution flag so far, and we are almost one-fifth of the way through this event. Dr. Jerry Punch is in the Jeff Bodine pit watching what's going on down there. What's the story, Jerry?
Well, Bob, you commented up in the booth about Jeff Bodine slowing down a little bit, and I think I just talked to the Bodine crew, and I said, well, that's basically because of Darrell Waltrip. Darrell Waltrip is up on the inside trying to make a move on the outside of Jeff Bodine down in turn one, and they sandwiched Bobby Hill and Waltrip now trying to take the lead in turn one. But what's happening is apparently is Waltrip worried Bodine so much he made Jeff use up his tires. They are side by side up the back straightaway. Waltrip trying to take the lead in turn three, but Bodine's tires have gone away basically, and Waltrip making his move to the front in turn four, Bob.
Wheel to wheel action. Still, Waltrip has not been able to take over the lead from Jeff Bodine at this point, but they are trading paint and rubbing against each other. as Bodine has done a terrific job of protecting that spot and keeping the lead. Waltrip, though, pulls ahead just a little bit several times, but is never able to get by completely.
Oh boy, this is wonderful. Can you imagine two or three laps side by side?
That's good racing, no doubt about it. These fans are loving it here at Martinsville.
Even got me on my feet.
And Alan Kowicki is right there in third position watching all of that. Alan Kowicki playing it very cautiously, knowing that these guys could take each other out here momentarily, and he would be in the catbird seat. And speaking of the fans, this place is almost full, except for just a couple of bottom rows on the backstretch. Martinsville, Virginia Speedway is full of race fans on this Sunday afternoon.
And I think those that bought those bottom row seats are standing up at the back, Bob. I think all the seats were sold, and so it is a jam-packed house.
Look at this race, the first five cars in the single train.
Wow.
Just like at Talladega, except a little bit slower than that. The number 84 car, meanwhile, of Dick Trickle continues to handle well as he has been moving up slowly throughout the field and now is on the back bumper of the number 4 car of Rick Wilson. Now, Wilson is in 7th and Dick Trickle in the number 84 Stavola Brothers car is 8th. The number 2 car of Ernie Irvin is being lapped. Not nearly as good a performance as he had at Bristol earlier this year when he led a great portion of the race. Unfortunately, was involved in an incident that took him out, but Ernie Irvin had a great performance in that race, struggling here at Martinsville. Back up front, meanwhile, we still see Jeff Bodine hanging on to the lead as Waltrip pursues him in the number 17 car, as they've been able to separate themselves a little bit from Alan Kowicki in third, as Kowicki got hung up behind some slower traffic, but the interval certainly isn't very much.
100 laps have been completed, and every one of them right now is saying, wow, when there's going to be a caution flag. Please, I need some more tires on this automobile. And the owners are all saying, wow, green flag racing. That means we don't have to spend any money for tires. They love it.
I tell you, there's one fellow that would really like to have a caution flag, and that's Mark Martin. He started in the third position, and we can see his car out in front here. There's Dale Jarrett and Rick Maston, 66. There's Mark Martin, has dropped back to about the 20th position. He started in third, but his car, we're watching here a little bit, it is not working very well. He slips out. Here goes Rick Maston on the inside. Here comes Dale Jarrett, going to try to make the pass as well. And so all of these drivers would certainly like to see a caution. You can see the leaders coming up behind them there. They're about to go a lap down.
The number 66 car picks up some sponsorship this weekend and is able to run this race from Raven Boats. Back is the battle for first and now for third position as Rusty Wallace and Alan Kowicki are there together, and Dale Earnhardt also.
We saw it coming off the fourth corner, the red car right in front of Jeff Bodine, Bill Elliott, about to be lapped for the second time. And let me tell you, from a race car driver's viewpoint, what Bill Elliott thought when he looked up and saw Jeff Bodine in his rearview mirror, he must have stopped and made a pit stop. He couldn't be behind me again.
There is Elliott just ahead, and Mark Martin also.
I tell you, it makes for a long day when just past 100 laps, you've been lapped twice. Your car just isn't working, and he is about to go down that second lap.
We are at a record-setting pace, 86.703 miles an hour in the first 100 laps. Jerry Punch is in the Mark Martin pit. What's going on down there, Jerry?
Bob, with crew chief Robin Pemberton. Robin, your car is backsliding a little bit. What's the problem?
Well, we started the race a little too loose, as cool as it was. We thought we'd try with a little more stagger than what we needed to, and this long green has really hurt us. But we're not discouraged. There's 400 laps left in the race. We'll be all right.
Well, the tire's going away. They're a little loose to start with, and the sun has come out. It's gotten a little bit warmer. He is now going down a lap, so they will have a lot of making up to do in the next 400 laps. Bob?
You can see how Mark Martin has slipped from his third starting position all the way back to 22nd at the end of 105 laps. He is a lap down. Bodine has already passed him. And now Darrell Waltrip also puts Mark Martin a lap down. The Strohlite Ford would like to have a caution period here so they can come in and make some adjustments to that car. The Battle of the Blue Ridge Mountains here at Martinsville, Virginia. On a Sunday afternoon, Bodine leads at Pannill Sweatshirts 500. NASCAR presenting Winston Cup Racing here on ESPN, the Pannill Sweatshirts 500 from Martinsville, Virginia. And the story is, at the end of 111 laps, Jeff Bodine, the Levi Garrett Chevrolet number 5, being pursued by his teammate, the 17 car, driven by Darrell Waltrip. Not too far behind is Alan Kowicki in third, and Rusty Wallace runs fourth. Dale Earnhardt is in fifth.
And Bob, as we went away to the commercial, we saw that Jeff Bodine was about to put the second lap on Bill Elliott, but so far hasn't been able to do it. Elliott hanging in there.
Here we see Rusty Wallace trying to get by Alan Kowicki. That's for third spot. And I was thinking of Jeff Bodine. You think he's thinking about the union money? The pole position winner, Jeff Bodine, can win $45,600 if he were to win the race today. Oh, looky here. Earnhardt on the inside of...
Oh, he gets up on the curbing momentarily and has to back off, loses some ground on the racetrack, doesn't lose a position, but that's how the curbing works here at Martinsville.
We understand that Jeff Hammond is continuing to give Darrell Waltrip a message, says watch your brakes, watch your brakes. And boy, that's something you have to conserve here.
There's the number 25 car of Ken Schrader, who is in sixth spot as he sets his sights on the number 3 car of Dale Earnhardt, passing the number 75 car driven by Morgan Shepherd, who won a race here at Martinsville in 1981. And Schrader appears to be closing in on Earnhardt.
He certainly is. And Darrell Waltrip doesn't have to worry about brakes, Ned. All he can do is just go down the corner and run in the back of the 5 car. He wouldn't have to use any brakes at all.
More than 100 laps gone, and everybody is still in competition. We have had no caution flags. When can we expect some pit stops? Well, certainly within the next 30 laps or so, I would think.
I would think so, because as we've said several times already, their tires are really getting worn and hot. Bobby Hillen has already made a pit stop for some fresh tires. And I think we'll see others coming in before too long. They can go about 160 or 70 laps as far as fuel is concerned, but they might not want to fight the tires that long, because they're beginning to slip around on the racetrack a little bit. And that's certainly not taking anything away from the tires, because this is a long green flag run, and they've really abused those tires.
Waltrip still in second position behind Jeff Bodine. Waltrip with victories this year at Daytona and at Atlanta. Jeff Bodine is winless this year, but is second in Winston Cup points because of his consistency. As a matter of fact, was the leader in Winston Cup points earlier.
Trouble up in turn 4.
We have several cars involved in an incident up here, and the leaders are also somewhat involved as Jeff Bodine tries to make his way through some crash cars and really damages the Levi Garrett Chevrolet. And there is Harry Gantz sliding on the grass to the inside, also involved Chad Little and Larry Pearson.
Well, they're going to get that break that they needed for tires, but Jeff Bodine certainly didn't want to be a part of it.
Jeff Bodine is smoking very badly in turn number 2, going down the backstretch as Chad Little gets his car righted. But look at Bodine. That car is damaged as he tried to move himself through a couple of cars that were in front of him. You can see the damage that he did to the Levi Garrett Chevrolet. The left rear tire is down. He's limping into the pit area at the end of 118 laps, and Darrell Waltrip is already in for the much-needed tire change as Jeff Hammond goes to work. Let's see now what he does with that jack. He's known for slinging it. Nope, he doesn't. He picks it up and carries it to the left side of the race car.
Yeah, he remembered that time. Let's go to Jerry Punch, who's in Jeff Bodine's pit.
Significant sheet metal damage on the left side of the car. They had to literally pick the right side of the car up to get the jack underneath the right side. Jeff Chandler, Waddell Wilson, and the rest of the crew working on the car, they're going to have to change 4 tires. The right side tires were flat, the right rear and left rear. Now they carry the jack around. They could not get the jack under the left side of the car. They have to pick the car up. They're trying to pick the car up. Now they get the jack under the car. Both left side tires will have to be changed. Looks like primarily cosmetic damage, but it's costing them a lot of time here under the caution flag.
Well, Jerry, they're going to have to hurry, or they could go a lap down. The caution car is coming off of turn 4. We see it there, but Jeff Bodine does get down, so he will stay in the lead lap.
Alan Kowicki got out of the pits first, and he has the lead with Earnhardt in second and Darrell Waltrip in third. And there's a lot of smoke still coming from the Bodine car as he works his way around the racetrack. Obviously, some sheet metal rubbing on the tire on the right rear. Now, here's a replay of what happened. Watch the 90 car of Chad Little.
And Harry Gantt went in and just touched him. And here's Larry Pearson that hits Harry Gantt. And then the leaders, you can see Dale Jarrett going by on the outside. Rick Mass gets through there. Here comes Dave Marks in the blue car. Darrell Waltrip went on the outside, but Jeff Bodine came through the middle. And, of course, he got clipped.
And here is the view from Harry Gant's car. Now watch him move to the inside of Chad Little here in three.
Going into turn three, and Little starts to come down. Harry touches him a little bit. Harry goes around, and you can see all of the other cars as it's come through. Some of them come through, and Jeff Bodine, you can see him hit as he came through.
Elliott got through that narrow opening, but Jeff Bodine didn't, and his car has been damaged. He comes in once again for a stop and goes back out now and maintains his position on the lead lap.
Bob, we saw a couple of cars go through the middle, and Jeff had already committed himself. He saw a couple of cars in front of him, but apparently one of those cars moved a little bit just as he was coming in there, and it just closed the hole up on him.
It looked like that Chad Little let the car roll back just a little bit when Jeff started by. Now, I may be wrong, but that's what it looked like.
All right, now the lead is held by Alan Kulwicki, car number 7. In second place is going to be the number 3 of Dale Earnhardt. As we remain under caution, the 17 car of Darrell Waltrip is in third. Let's go back down to the Bodine pit.
Well, Jeff Bodine, again, for the third time during this caution flag, they're trying to bend some of the sheet metal away, and apparently they put fresh tires on the right side, but the sheet metal is rubbing, and it has possibly have a problem with the tire. They will not have time to change the tire. They have to get him down and away because the safety car is coming down across the start-finish line. He will have to come back in again and possibly get that right front tire change and beat some more sheet metal away as he has a heavily damaged Levi Garrett Chevrolet. Bob?
Just barely made it out on the track before losing a lap. There is the field behind the pace car as the cleanup continues down between turns 3 and 4. Because of the crash that was originally begun with Harry Gant and Chad Little coming together, but has involved the then leader, Jeff Bodine. Back in a moment. In another lap, we'll go back to racing after our first caution period of the afternoon. And it involved an accident. Harry Gant among those involved with Chad Little, and here's the way it looked from Harry's vantage point as they went into turn number 3. That's Little there on the outside.
And Harry started to move on the inside, and it looks like Little came down just a little bit as he started into the turn, spins Little out, and Harry Gant also spins as he gets down on the Kirby.
And now we see the camera stops it. We see the blue car sitting there, and the car's rolling, is it not?
Yes.
Yes, the car starts rolling. It rolls right in front of the leader, Jeff Bodine.
Just closed the hole up on him.
Good eyes. That's the reason why the hole closed up and there was no room for Jeff Bodine. He is a lap down as we go back to racing. And the lead now goes to Alan Kulwicki with Earnhardt, Waltrip, Wallace chasing him.
Wow, look at Earnhardt close up on Kulwicki in the middle of the corner.
That, of course, is Elliott that is being passed by the leaders.
Now, he's only one lap down. He stayed out in front of them. He was about to go 2 laps down at one time, but he was able to stay out in front of them, and then when that caution came out, he got to go all the way around.
Rusty Wallace side by side with Will Elliott. Rusty in fourth. There is the damage we see from Ricky Rudd's car of the damage on the rear end of the Skull Bandit driven by Harry Gant.
Well, that's what caused Harry Gant to spin out. It wasn't the crash with Chad Little, but the fact that someone behind hit him in the back, as we see, and spun him out.
Quite a bit of damage to the Skull Bandit, but not nearly as much damage as was sustained by the Levi Garrett Chevrolet.
Boy, look at the top of the screen and how heavy that traffic is as it came off of turn 4. A lot of cars back there running side by side.
Once again, we go inside Ricky Rudd's Quaker State Buick. Ahead of him is Morgan Shepherd and Harry Gant.
Shepherd made that quick move to the inside there to get down on the inside of the racetrack. Morgan is at least one lap down. His car just not working in the early part of the race.
Ricky Rudd, the driver we are riding with, is in 10th position. Meanwhile, there are the first 4 as they're very close. Darrell Waltrip closing in on Dale Earnhardt for second place. Rusty Wallace is also right there. Kulwicki now with a 4, 5, or 6, or 7 car length advantage on Earnhardt.
That first lap after the restart, it looked like Earnhardt just closed up on Kulwicki, but now Kulwicki has put a couple of car lengths on Dale Earnhardt. We can see that. Kulwicki has been a surprise. I don't know if surprise the correct word I'm looking for, Ned. this year in Alan Kulwicki's case? Or?
Well, I don't know. He came on strong towards the end of last year, and I think people expected a lot out of him this year. Certainly he expected a lot because his team just keeps coming together more and more every week, and it's a very strong team, and they're to be contended with every week. So it might be a surprise to some people, especially in the fact that it's somewhat of an independent type of situation. He owns the team and manages it and all of that. And they say that can't be done in this day of Winston Cup racing, but he does a whale of a job of it.
You remember a few years ago when Harry Gant was referred to as the bridesmaid? He had several races there when he finished in second position. That's pretty much the situation with Alan Kulwicki. He's finished second three times this year. There's Jeff Bodine as he continues to struggle and go back up toward the front and get a lap back. Unfortunately, the crash has put him a lap down. Jerry Punch can update us on the damage to that car suffered in the accident. Jerry?
Bob, they got most of the sheet metal peeled away from the tires. The one thing they could not fix during the caution flag was the toe end. The right front tire is towed out, according to Waddell Wilson, the crew chief, so it'll be a little more of a difficult car to drive. Sort of a bucking Bronco here at Martinsville, but they lost only the one lap. Not as a result of their pit stop. They were held a lap by NASCAR for passing cars under the caution to get back to pit road. They passed six cars in the backstretch, and NASCAR, the ruling is you can't do that to close up. They held them a lap. Otherwise, they wouldn't have lost any time. So they one lap down. They got their work cut out for them. But they got a problem with the right front tire.
Well, Jerry, it's not affecting him too much on the racetrack because he's coming up through traffic, picking them off one at a time, and is really doing a good job. So whatever the problem is with that front end, he's making up for it in the driving because he's coming up through the pack.
Well, they are very confident with Bodine's ability. You know, Jeff Bodine is probably one of the masters, he and Darrell Walker, at running this track as he goes around the Rick Mass car, the Raven Boats machine. And Bodine, one lap down here to Bodine is next to nothing. We know we've seen it happen all year long, people making up a lap, and Bodine and the Levi Garrett crew are pretty excited about coming away from that accident with only a lap lost.
Well, I don't think I've ever heard as much noise from a relatively small group of people than when Richard Petty qualified here on Friday afternoon. The crowd just went absolutely wild. Richard qualified good enough for 17th position. He knew he was in the field solidly. And I'll tell you, the fans really celebrated along with Richard in breaking this streak of bad luck.
David, a standing ovation when he got out of that race car. Benny Parsons was doing a broadcast on a local radio station here. And I'll tell you, it was really something.
It was one of the nicest moments that I've seen in motor racing. I've been doing this 25 years. And that crowd reaction Friday was one of the best I've ever seen. Never see Darrell Walter on the inside of Earnhardt, and the people are up again.
And it's a battle for second position. Earnhardt is going to try to hang on. He's on the outside lane, not the quickest, but is struggling to maintain second position. Waltrip is on the inside as they head for turn number three. Rusty Wallace is watching all this from behind. Side-by-side competition still. I believe Waltrip is going to get him. Yes, indeed. Darrell goes to second, and now we'll watch Rusty Wallace try to take over third from Earnhardt.
Earnhardt's car just moving out a little bit in the turns. And, boys, we've said several times you can't do that here on this racetrack. You get out just a half a car width, they're going to stick a nose at you.
And Earnhardt knew if Darrell got by that 27 was going by as well.
Great crowd on hand here as they watch the Winston Cup action from Martinsville, a track that's been known for its tight competition and for the slamming and banging that goes on every race. We've already seen some of it already. In fact, an accident up in the third and fourth turns has put Jeff Bodine, who led for the first 117 laps, a lap down and struggling with some bent sheet metal. We have completed 142 laps out of 500 that make up the Pannill Sweatshirts 500, and we'll have more of our coverage after these messages. King Richard Petty has pulled behind the wall. They're working on the STP Pontiac, but he made contact with the fourth turn wall and did some damage to it. We will see him as he comes out of the fourth corner, and
you see the blue car, the blue with the red bumper, and then wham, right into the wall he goes with it. I think a tire went down. I think he cut a tire as he came off of the fourth turn, and you can see Richard Petty is very dejected about it. Well, Jack Arute has more on the story. Jack?
Well, let's see if we can get a word with Richard. Richard, did a tire go down? Is that what put you into the wall?
Do what?
He's using this special, actually it's a gas mask to keep the fumes inside the car. So every time he has to talk, it's a lot like a fighter pilot to keep the carbon monoxide out. But he has the radio in there, so he has to actually hold it up to his mouth to talk to his crew. Working with it, they blew both tires on the outside, and it looks as if we're going to let him get his repair so he can get back into the race, Bob.
Well, you'll recall that the Petty Enterprises team hired Larry Rothkeb, a former Chrysler executive, to join this team just earlier this week. And I think it's a little too early maybe to lay the credit completely on Rothkeb for making this race. They had tested here at Martinsville, of course, but I think you can look for much better performances from that team with the addition of Larry Rothkeb. Fifth and sixth position here being contested. That's Ken Schrader in the red number 25 and Rick Wilson in number 4. And Harry Ginn is right behind him at number 33 as we go inside his car.
Harry Ginn said, come on, Rick, get by so I can follow you.
Yeah, he made a hole there for Ginn, so he's just trying to get down on the inside.
Harry, you know what happened the last time you tried that, Harry? Well, this time it didn't happen.
No, he got up there far enough, plus the fact that Ken Schrader gave him the running room down on the inside.
The 84 car of Dick Trickle is right behind Schrader now. As a matter of fact, moving to the inside in turn number 1 as Trickle, in seventh position, is trying to take away sixth from Ken Schrader. And he pulls alongside Schrader once again in the third and fourth turns as Schrader struggles to maintain the position. And now we see it from out the back glass of the Harry Gantt car. And it looks as if Schrader is going to lose the spot. Indeed, Dick Trickle passes and takes over the sixth position.
And now Harry Gantt sees Trickle out the back of his rear view mirror. Sees him coming on strong.
There are the leaders, meanwhile. It is Alan Kulwicki.
And look, Rusty Wallace is the second place car now. He got by Darrell Walter just a moment ago. I think we have a picture of it. Yes, we do. Going down in turn one. Darrell goes up the racetrack a little bit, and look how quickly Wallace jumped to the inside and took that position away.
Now, Benny, race drivers and crew members will talk about it. Can't get the car cut in the corner. If you make a car cut on a short corner like Martinsville here, that is a mark of a good handling race car, and that right there we saw it work.
It did work. Whew.
And now we see Ricky Rudd, Michael Waltrip, Terry Labonte, Brett Bodine, and Jeff Bodine. And we saw some flames coming out of that number 30 car. A backfire, maybe? What could that be all about?
Yes, I'm sure that's what it is a backfiring situation. If we listen to him down the... when we go back to the in-car camera, maybe we can listen to the engine a little bit and see.
We'll watch from the outside to see if we can see anything. And it would happen normally as it goes into the turns. Of course, Waltrip in the yellow car, the bright yellow car, Country Time Lemonade. Didn't see anything, but here's a battle.
Now we see Dale Earnhardt about to take third place away from Darrell Waltrip. So Waltrip is struggling here momentarily. Here is Dale Earnhardt now taking the position away. And Ben Hess in the number 40 car comes right along. And I don't think that 17 car is performing nearly as well as it did earlier.
Of course it isn't, because Darrell Waltrip was a class of the field just 50 laps ago. Right now, he's having problems maintaining.
So now it is Dale Earnhardt in third, and we're inside Michael Waltrip's car. We'll listen and see if the car backfires.
Don't hear any backfire there on his car. Seems to be running okay.
Jack LaRoute, who maybe can, Jerry Punch, I should say, to give us an update on this situation with Michael.
Well, they have been struggling all week, Bob. You know, they lost their good short track car at Wilkesboro last week when they did their invitation of a cue ball up in turn 4, and Rick Wilson bounced at him and took the rear of the car off. So they have had a lot of trouble with the car. This car they have here, the Mike Walter car, is an old car, an old short track car. They had it at a car show last week. I tell you how much trouble this car is. They say it jumped off the trailer on the way back to the car show and rolled down a bank into a dirt embankment. They had to rebuild the car from the firewall forward, so they have been struggling all week long. They are having their difficulties. Another driver is having his difficulty, maybe backsliding in the field. Up in their pits, at the Darrell Walter pits, is Jack LaRoute. Jack?
Well, Jerry, the problem that they're having with with the car on Darrell Waltrip is when they made the exchange of tires last time, they put on a little different stagger. I checked with Jeff Hammond, and he said the stagger is not to the liking of the car. It's gotten very, very loose. So basically what Darrell has begun to do is try and settle into a rhythm here at Martinsville and wait for the next caution where they'll readjust the stagger with those rear tires, and hopefully he'll handle a little bit better. Bob?
All right, now, as we have a full field rundown at the end of 150 laps, last week we ran the radials and had zero stagger. What about Martinsville? About what kind of a stagger do you run?
Well, they're bi-ply tires, and most of the guys in the back, as Ned talked a moment ago, getting the car to turn in the middle is so critical. So here you would run probably an inch and a half stagger in the front. In other words, the left front would be an inch and a half smaller in circumference than the right front. And the rear, the right rear, about 1 inch larger than the left rear.
There is the leader, Alan Kulwicki, as he took over the lead from Jeff Bodine when Bodine was involved in that little incident. Jeff Bodine, you saw, back in 22nd position. Now here comes Rusty Wallace sneaking up on Alan Kulwicki, and we may have a battle for the lead here in a moment. That's the 83 car Blake Speed that is being passed. Meanwhile, it is Terry Labonte, Michael Waltrip, and Brett Bodine, and Jeff Bodine.
Brett Bodine is going to watch his older brother and say, okay, I just want to see how you get around this racetrack so well. He's going to try to follow him. That's Jeff Bodine in the yellow and white 5, Brett Bodine in the red and white 15, Terry Labonte in the red and white 11, leading that group right now.
And Labonte is in 11th position as we go inside the Michael Waltrip car again. There you can see Sterling Marlin going to the inside and passing Michael. Back to the leaders, meanwhile, as Rusty Wallace now is making a battle for the lead, a bid for it. Kulwicki struggling to maintain the spot. Rusty moving in, trying to get his nose under Kulwicki. They come down the front straightaway, then Rusty will fall in behind Allen. The 75 car of Morgan Shepherd is just ahead of Kulwicki.
Well, I tell you what, that picture has been commonplace in 1989. Alan Kulwicki and Rusty Wallace, and he's on the inside. Ooh, yes, a little bit of contact.
Side by side as they cross the stripe. Kulwicki with about a half a car length advantage. We'll see what Rusty can do entering the turn. He pulls alongside Alan. I think he may have him as he forces Alan high. Yes, indeed. Rusty Wallace takes over the lead of the Pannill Sweatshirts 500.
Alan coming back on the outside. Maybe he wants to get him in behind the 75. Can he do it? Can he take away the racing room? No.
Shepherd went to the inside, backed off, and let him go ahead. And so Rusty does have the advantage.
Well, you can see the battle scars on the outside of Wallace's car where he rubbed against Alan Kulwicki as he made that pass. But as we said at the top of the show, you just about have to nudge someone a little bit in order to move around them. We'll see if Alan returns the favor.
I don't think he's going to catch him, Ned.
Yeah, that'll be the problem.
Rusty Wallace comes into this race fourth in the point standings, only 30 behind. And that's an interesting story. Last year, when we went into this race, the first four were separated by 67 points. Now they're separated by 30 and 89. And here again is the replay of how Rusty Wallace took over the lead from Allen.
Well, he got a nose up beside of him coming off the turn and moved down on the inside going into turn one. You can see Morgan Shepherd's car just ahead of him. And there you can see Rusty slip out and nudge Alan Kulwicki just a little bit, but he holds the inside lane, then pulls away as they come off the corner.
All right, the number 84 car of Dick Trickle has just passed the 17 of Darrell Waltrip. This again in replay as Trickle continues to be impressive, moving up to fourth place already.
Yeah, he just outbraked Darrell going into the corner that time, drove down on the inside. As Waltrip's car, as we heard, is a little bit loose, went up a little bit, Trickle made the pass.
Third leader of the afternoon is Rusty Wallace from Fenton, Missouri. He has the advantage over Alan Kulwicki and Dale Earnhardt at the moment. We'll be right back. The beautiful countryside surrounding Martinsville Speedway and a huge crowd on hand here for the Pannill Sweatshirts 500. What's the hat of the week? Well, it's appropriate to Martinsville Speedway. Here's Benny.
In keeping with the Hat of the Week theme, what a more perfect hat than the Norfolk Southern hat sent to me by J.E. Presson of Suffolk, Virginia. We see the racetrack right behind the train. J.E., thank you very much for the Norfolk Southern hat. And this hat is going to the Scotts Hill Volunteer Fire Department in Wilmington, North Carolina, for their celebrity auction. Now, last week, you watching the people that watched the North Wilkesboro race, you saw me wearing the Boy Scout cap all day, and you kept expecting me to say something. Bobby Earle from Unadilla, New York, Troop 1, I'm sorry I didn't mention your name. There just was never a time to do that. But this was sent by Bobby Earle, Troop 1, Boy Scouts, Unadilla, New York. Thank you, Bobby. Hey, that's a real train, folks.
The hat of the week, one of the little unique little things that we've come up with here, and you can send your hat to Benny Parsons, 112 Main Street in Ellerby, North Carolina, 28338. The leader, Rusty Wallace and Alan Kowicki, involves in some heavy traffic here. As Wallace tries to go inside of Michael Waltrip, he's got Dale Jarrett ahead of him and also Dave Marcus.
And Earnhardt back there, the three, black three, is passing Alan Kowicki for second spot right now. Harry Gant just passed him. Harry trying to get a lap back. He's heading for Rusty Wallace.
Boy, that is some real racing in there as everybody tries to maneuver in position. There goes Gant on the inside of Michael Waltrip. There's Earnhardt trying to find some running room. Rusty Wallace has still not been able to move around Dale Jarrett. Jarrett almost lost his car about three or four laps ago. He's running in the 16th position, I believe. He's the last car on the lead lap.
Yeah, Harry Gant in the 33 car is a lap down now in 17th position.
We saw him sitting sideways up in turn four. That's when Harry got lapped, when he was spun out. While he was sitting there, the leaders went by.
This is from Harry Gant's car, looking out the back glass at Dale Earnhardt.
Harry Gant is no slouch when it comes to the Martinsville Speedway. Gets around this racetrack rather well.
Alan Kowicki just able to pass Michael Waltrip.
And Gant's on the inside of Rusty Wallace. If the camera would go just a little bit to the right, we'd see our leader. Yes, Harry Gant gives. And look, Earnhardt's on the inside. This is for the lead.
Dale Earnhardt is going for it. He has it. Rusty just suddenly slowed there and allowed several cars to pass by. And Earnhardt now goes into the lead. Let's go to Jerry Punch on pit road.
No surprise at all to see Harry Gant making up a lap here at Martinville. He was one of the dominant cars in this race a year ago. He led early on, only to have the engine come unglued, then dropping from Mach 1. It's the same car we saw him win with on ESPN at Darlington. He has driven this car in every single race this year, with the exception of Daytona and Wilkesboro when the car was being reskinned. They've nicknamed it Alf because it's a weird animal that seems to work everywhere. And Gant's running off the wheel, now back in the lead lap.
He certainly is, and so there are 17 cars now on the lead lap as Gant goes back into the lead lap. Once again, we're looking out the back glass of the Skull Bandit, and Dale Jarrett with a new paint job on that Hardy's car. They've made the front hood of it orange, making it much more visible. And here now is Rusty Wallace, and that's how close he is to the leader, Dale Earnhardt. 31 of the 32 cars are still in this race.
Richard Petty, the only car that's behind the pit wall right now.
And so Earnhardt, Rusty Wallace and Alan Kowicki are running very close together on the racetrack, but for the moment, it is Earnhardt showing the way in the Pannill Sweatshirts 500. We'll be back with our coverage after this. NASCAR's Winston Cup Division at the Pannill Sweatshirts 500 this afternoon in Martinsville, Virginia. And we have had five leaders so far, and right at the moment, the number three car of Dale Earnhardt is showing the way in the Chevy Monte Carlo. Chassis wins in NASCAR. Pontiac and Chevrolet each have three. Oldsmobile has one victory.
As strong as the 89 Ford Thunderbird was thought to be going into the year, it's almost inconceivable at this point, winless so far in 1989.
Well, the 27 car of Rusty Wallace has a very interesting nickname. For that story, let's go pit road in Jackaroo.
Well, you know, Bob, it was only about 10 years ago where people would laugh when drivers would nickname their cars. Darrell Waltrip brought the legendary Maybelline, the big old Monte Carlo, and he won so many races with that. But now all drivers do. We've heard about Whitney so many times, the car that Rusty Wallace has driven to so many victories. Well, this is not Whitney. This is Tia, T-I-A, and it's named after Barry Dotson's daughter. They said that they wanted to name one because she said, if they've got a Whitney, why can't they name one after me, Daddy?
Well, uh-oh, we may have some trouble up here. Now everybody gets straightened out. Phil Parsons almost sideways, and now we're going to have a change of lead, it appears, as here comes Kowicki outside. Nope, the lead remains with Earnhardt, but second place now is in a questionable situation. Well, Wallace
that's the
comes
lead
out with second.
That's the lead that's questionable. Rusty Wallace on the inside of Earnhardt.
Two good friends slugging it out on the racetrack, just as they did last weekend in North Wilkesboro. Rusty has the inside line going into one. Is there going to be enough room in there for both of them? Well, they get through the corner okay. Who comes out on top? Well, Wallace.
Yeah, he's been getting off of that number two corner awfully well down on the inside of the racetrack. And now a little bump from Earnhardt. Here comes Earnhardt back on the inside. They bump again.
Now Alan Kowicki pulls alongside of Earnhardt to challenge him for second. And look at Dick Trickle there at number 84 as he is in the mix.
A moment ago, he was almost 3 seconds behind them, but as they battle up front, he has run them down.
There are the first four cars. Wallace, Earnhardt, Kowicki, and Dick Trickle. The number 55 car of Phil Parsons is not in the battle for position.
Well, here's the replay of what happened there a moment ago. Dale Earnhardt right behind Dale Jarrett. And Dave Marcus goes on the inside of Phil Parsons. Phil tries to get back down. Jarrett tries to jump in the hole. And he and Parsons get together a little bit. And Phil gets sideways. Earnhardt was on the high side. He bumps Phil again. And it really was a heavy traffic jam there for a moment.
And it scrambled the standings once again. Now there is the leader, Rusty Wallace. And he still has some traffic ahead of him. Let's go down to Jack Arute, who has more on the Wallace and Earnhardt situation.
Well, Bob, you talked so many times about how such good friends that Rusty Wallace and Dale Earnhardt are. Well, remember last week they were in a bumper tag match there at North Wilkesboro Speedway. Well, this week during practice, they got together, and there was some really good-natured ribbing between the two drivers, but there was an underlying message as well. Earnhardt really got on Wallace's case for his driving tactics, and it somewhat concerned Wallace. Wallace kept coming back and pleading and saying, but we're always such good friends after the race, no matter what. And all Earnhardt would do was shake his head and walk away. So while they're friends, Earnhardt was certainly delivering a message back to his purported friend about while some of it's okay, a lot of it is too much to take. Back up to you.
Now they have indeed been rubbing fenders out there for the last couple of races. And earlier in the weekend, our question was, being such good friends, has some of the aggressiveness rubbed off on Rusty?
His car is running real good, and anytime you're as competitive as he is, it looks aggressive, but he's just running good and doing everything right. We get our operation as fine-tuned as he is, and get up there and race with him, we'll see what aggressive is.
Well, there is a lot of pros and cons when it comes to being friends with Dale, but I don't really much care. He's a good friend of mine, and if you're going to run hard, you're going to run up front, there's going to be a little aggressiveness, and there's going to be a lot of boos. And if say there's 100,000 people in Grandstand, I'd probably get about 60,000 boos.
Well, we talk about how much good friends Dale Earnhardt and Rusty Wallace is. You know where Dale Earnhardt is going tonight after the race? Well, the one place you would not expect Dale Earnhardt to go. He is going to driving school. He is going to leave Martinsville Speedway, fly to Atlanta. He will arrive in San Francisco at 1:45 a.m. Eastern Time, and he will attend the Bob Bondurant Road Racing School this week at Sears Point, where we'll be in June on ESPN. Can you believe it? Earnhardt was laughing at himself this morning when I was talking to him. He said, I can't believe I'm going to driving school tonight. Gentlemen?
Well, I hope he makes a passing grade. I'm sure he will. Now the battle for third is shaping up as the number seven car of Alan Kowicki and Dick Trickle are contesting that spot.
Alan Kowicki in the 7 car might have some damage on the right front of that car because he and Dale Jarrett got together up in turn 4 just a moment ago, and it looked to me like it was pretty hard contact. He may have some toe-end problems there.
Trickle all over him coming down the straightaway. Locked in on the back bumper of the number 7 car of Kowicki.
Trickle's car is working well here today, and certainly he's driving it well.
couple of ASA veterans, Kowicki from Greenfield, Wisconsin, and Dick Trickle from Wisconsin Rapids, Wisconsin.
One and a four. That's Kowicki and a Buick by Trickle.
Harry Gann making a pit stop on the backstretch. Without question, he was one of the fastest cars on the racetrack prior to this pit stop. He had lapped himself and begun to pull away from everybody else. But you can see Harry now sits patiently in the car while they change the rubber on the right side, and Gann goes back out onto the racetrack.
Patiently damaged to the left rear as it went out, because that happened in that earlier encounter.
You say patiently. Easy for you to say.
Well, it appears to be patient.
Appears to be patient.
There Rusty is Earnhardt in second, and battle for third here, Kowicki and Dick Trickle.
Rusty Wallace put a few car lengths on the on Dale Earnhardt. He's now probably about 10 or 15 car lengths ahead of Earnhardt. Earnhardt, 10 or 15 ahead of Kowicki and Dick Trickle, the battle we see right now for third spot. Kowicki in the 7, Dick Trickle in the gold and white 84.
A record attendance on hand here at Martinsville Speedway today. 43,000 is the announced attendance for Clay Earl's very well-maintained and beautiful Martinsville Speedway. Well, Jack Arud is down in the pit area with the crew chief on this Dick Trickle car.
And that's Jimmy Fenning, and Fenning had such a great run with Bobby Allison, and now with a rookie at 47 years of age, it looks like Trickle's brought a lot to the party here for the Stavola team.
Yeah, Dick's running pretty good. We're pretty pleased. Car's looking real good. We'll just have to see what happens, see if the track gets a little bit slicker. But right now, we're sitting around pretty neutral.
Well, they're very, very pleased down here, and you can be sure that one gentleman in Dewitown, Alabama is pleased as well, and that's Bobby Allison, and everybody still says, hurry back, Bobby.
We hope someday Bobby Allison will, if he chooses, to get back in a race car, but the Stavola brothers' tradition being carried on well by the drivers that are now with that team. And there is Kowicki moving to the inside, and here is Rusty Wallace, as he now tries to put another lap on the number 9 car.
Wallace. Bill was already one lap down, Bill Elliott was. Now Wallace is about to put a second lap on him. We saw him come up on the leader a while ago to put a second lap on him, but Elliott was able to stay out there until that caution came out, but now has gone two laps down. And right in front of him now, in front of Rusty Wallace, is Terry Labonte and the Budweiser board of Junior Johnson about to go a lap down.
There's Wallace out of the fourth corner, and just ahead, Junior Johnson's number 11, piloted by Terry Labonte.
Terry had a good qualifying run here, starting in the fourth position, and thought that he had a good chance of winning. Of course, he's not out of it yet, but about to go a lap down. It'd be awfully tough to make up if indeed Rusty Wallace does get by.
219 laps have been completed here in the Pannill Sweatshirts 500. The lead is being held by Rusty Wallace, and we'll be back right after this. Lap 228, and the caution comes out because of a spin in turn 4 involving Michael Waltrip, and now pit road becomes extremely busy as just about everybody comes in for a tire change and some fuel. Dale Earnhardt is in, and Dr. Jerry Punch is right there.
Well, everyone's on pit road. Earnhardt and Wallace pitting nose to tail here, just about the midpoint of pit road. They come around to the left side of the Goodrich Chevrolet. David Smith out, changing left side tires. Wallace on top of your screen, Earnhardt on the bottom. Who's going to win the race off pit road? Earnhardt's car down and away. Wallace's car now off the jacket, heads take it for a moment, and now fires and heads down pit road, as does Labonte and Waltrip and the rest of the crew. Four tire changes, routine, rapid service here at Martinsville.
Tell you what, you know, earlier on this year at Rockingham, we saw Alan Kowicki's crew. Every time that they stopped, he would get beat by a second or two, and it really cost him a chance to win. And a lot of people asked me about Kowicki's crew. And today, his crew has had some excellent pit stops, and I think we ought to give him credit for that, because he went in third, came out second. And when you can do that against Rusty Wallace, Barrett Dawson, that crew, you've done a job.
You really have, because they are one of the best in the business, and I think Kowicki's crew has improved.
Let's take a look at the reason why we are under caution. Michael Waltrip's car at the top of your screen now. We'll see what happens.
You can see him break loose as he comes out of the turn. Here's Jeff Bodine in the yellow car here, but Michael Waltrip down on the inside. The car just makes a 360. Other cars darting around on each side, but he keeps going. It looked like there was some smoke coming from the car, and it perhaps was some tire smoke. Let's just listen to it.
Oh! Did you see how quickly that car went around?
Yeah, it, that's how it went to hurry.
Jump out from under you.
Like a top.
But no other car was involved, and so our second caution period of the day is out, and it allows everybody to come in and get some fresh rubber, and we should be going green here in just a few moments. Let's go down to Jerry Punch now with a story on an idiot light. Jerry?
I guess that's what I should be called by holding this thing, maybe, but now some of the drivers have nicknamed this the idiot light. Now, what it is, actually, brakes are so important here at Martinsville, and through a long afternoon, a 4 or 5 hour race, the drivers may get a little bit tired, and their left foot may be on that brake pedal just resting up there. If you leave that foot on the brake pedal, the brakes will not have any time to cool off. So in order to prevent that from happening, the crews have come up with this, what the drivers have called the idiot light. This little plunger here goes behind the brake pedal, and right here, when the brake pedal is depressed at all by a resting left foot, this light will come on in the dash to tell the driver that, hey, lift that left foot off, you'll have no brakes. Another device here in NASCAR, an idiot light for brake pedals.
Well, I'm glad I didn't get confused and say we go down to the idiot Jerry Punch with a report instead of the idiot light report by Jerry Punch.
You didn't say that?
I don't think I did. 230 laps are completed. We are under caution at the Pannill Sweatshirts 500 in Martinsville, Virginia. Stay with us. Back at Martinsville, and the green flag comes out on lap 232. We're nearing the halfway mark of the Pannill Sweatshirts 500. And in the lead at the moment is Dale Earnhardt after the series of pit stops. Resulting from the Michael Waltrip spin in turn four, Alan Kowicki is in second position with Rusty Wallace in third. That's Michael Waltrip positioned between the first and second place cars. Now Alan Kowicki moves to the inside of Michael Waltrip in the third turn. And here comes Rusty Wallace. Errol Waltrip in car number 17 is fourth, Trickle fifth. And here's the view from Harry Gant's car as he looks on Darrell Waltrip's back bumper.
Gant's still running very strong. He's one lap down as a result of the unscheduled pit stop under green. Running in 10th position, 9 cars now in the lead lap.
You can hear where the drivers let off on the accelerator about midway down the front stretch and the back stretch. We understand there may be a right front going down on the 17 car. We'll watch for that.
Well, he's able to stay right down on the inside on that racetrack. We'll see. Most of the time, if the right front is going down, it'll make the car push out a little bit in the corner. Jack Arute, what do you know about that?
Ned, it was a very close call. They thought Darrell actually radioed in and thought that he had a tire going down. But they, you know, as they do, they go into the corners. He tried a couple of different lanes, and he says, I think I can live with it. It's certainly not going down. It may have just gone a little soft.
Well, he's hanging right in there in fourth spot. Meanwhile, here's the battle for second as Wallace and Alan Kowicki battle for it. And Rusty has second spot now and pursues the leader, Dale Earnhardt. There you can see how far Earnhardt is ahead. Not all that far. Rusty and Kowicki second and third with the fourth place car of Darrell Waltrip and then Dick Trickle.
It is impressive how Rusty Wallace is able to come off the corner on the bottom of the racetrack and the thing not spin or the car not get sideways. Normally, you have to let the car just drift up the racetrack to keep the back end in. But not Rusty Wallace. He's able to get on the gas and drive it right on the bottom.
Yeah, just cut it left and drive on the bottom. That really is something remarkable on a track like this, that it can do that and still get traction.
The Gillette Halfway Challenge is coming up. The driver who leads lap 250 will earn the money. And here comes the leader off the corner.
Russell appears to be gaining a little bit on Earnhardt.
He is gaining on Earnhardt. He certainly is. He's driven away from Alan Kowicki by 4 or 5 car lengths. And he's gained on it. Dale Earnhardt the same amount by 4 or 5 car lengths.
Boy, that car is really working down on the inside of the racetrack. It's like Waltrip's car was early in the race, and from that Darrell Waltrip's car when he went up through the pack and eventually took the lead.
I think Jared Waltrip probably has a good car. He still has a good car. I don't think he's just found the right combination of tires to get him back up to the front right now.
But he's still running in fourth position, so he's in good shape. There he is.
Well, he's certainly not a driver who charges toward the front and wants to lead every lap either, but look for him at the end of the race. He sometimes is right there to strike in the late going. Back in just a moment. ESPN Speed World today at Martinsville, Virginia Speedway, under green and a change of lead perhaps as Rusty Wallace moves to the inside of Dale Earnhardt and tries to go to the point. They side by side, they touch and they rub, and Rusty Wallace comes out with the lead.
Boy, that car works well down on the inside. He just gets it down, steps it left, stands on the gas and goes away.
Rusty Wallace was the winner of the 1986 Goodies 500, the fall race here at Martinsville, so he has a victory on this racetrack.
Rusty Wallace certainly has been the news in Winston Cup racing in the past 6 or 8 months. And you know, as good of friends as they are, we keep talking about Earnhardt and Rusty. Earnhardt's going to get tired of being passed one of these days. He's going to pass back.
Well, he has won the 3 of the first 7 races in 1989, Rusty Wallace has, and 7 of the last 12 Winston Cup races. So you're right, Benny. He has been the story in Winston Cup racing since late last year, or the middle part of last year.
Well, we're talking about DW. Darrell Waltrip, look at him. He's moving up on Alan Kowicki there now, beginning to ramble again. He was strong in the first part of the race and moved all the way from his 10th starting position up to a second position, and now he's working on Alan Kowicki for third.
They talked about a flat run, right front tire just a moment ago. I would say that Darrell, on the first couple laps after the restart, that the right front tire was sliding across the racetrack, and this racetrack is very slick right now. Darrell probably thought he had a right front tire simply because it wouldn't grip, but after a couple of laps the tire is beginning to grip. He's looking good.
We are halfway through this race. 250 laps have been completed, and here is how close they are running. Rusty Wallace leads. He's been one of 5 leaders that we have had. Rusty, who is in fourth position in the Winston Cup point standings going in. Dale Earnhardt is in second position at the moment. He also has been a leader in the first half of the race. Alan Kowicki has led. He's in third. And so has Darrell Waltrip, who is in fourth position. Right behind the Waltrip car is Harry Gant, but he is a lap down. And then comes fifth place, Dick Trickle.
The other leader of the race, and probably the fellow who has led more than anyone else, Jeff Bodine, but involved in an early crash coming off turn 4. He's now a lap down.
We're inside Harry Gant's car. We see Darrell Waltrip just ahead, and also Alan Kowicki.
Rick Mast just went into the pits as we watched this battle. A lot of smoke coming from his car. Here he is coming into the pits, the Raven Boats car, sponsored here by Raven Boats. And here is Rusty Wallace, the leader of the race.
2 bad that Gant lost that lap, because that car has been performing very well both before and after the accident.
You know, Rusty Wallace is impressive right now, Ned, simply because he got the lead just a moment ago, and I feel like if Wallace could drive away, could probably drive away from Dale Earnhardt. But why use the car up? Rusty Wallace right now is taking care of his equipment as best he can to make sure that he has something to race with the last 100 laps of this race.
Yeah, that's smart, and it's awfully easy to sometimes just sort of lose track of things out there, and the car's running so well, and say, hey, boy, let me just pull away from him and put him a lap down. He knows it would be tough to put those guys a lap down, and the smart thing to do is to get out front, sit there and ride, conserve the car as much as you can, because that last 100 laps is very, very important here. That's when you see cars going away, the brakes losing, and cars start losing traction and all that kind of thing.
Tell you something else it does, Bob. Excuse me just a second. I'll tell you something else it does. It gives those drivers behind you, they think that they can outrun you, so they keep using their cars up a little more and a little more because they can see you right up there in front of them. If you drove away from them, they say, wait a minute, let me take care of my car because he's using his up. Rusty making the other drivers use their cars.
Good point.
I believe that's also the philosophy that Darrell Waltrip may be using right now, just sitting back there, not letting the leader get too far ahead, but saving the car until the final 100 laps or so. Well, the first five are running very close together on the racetrack as we are more than halfway finished with the Pannill Sweatshirts 500. There once again is third and fourth position of Alan Kulwicki and Darrell Waltrip with the Gantt number 33 car not on the lead lap, but nevertheless making himself back there being observed by Darrell Waltrip.
I tell you one thing, we can see that Harry Gantt's behind Darrell Waltrip. But believe me, Darrell Waltrip knows Harry Gantt's behind him.
Well, Richard Petty, who did drop out of the race, has gone back into competition. So I believe that everybody is still running. Here is the full field rundown at the end of 250 laps. If we have lost a car or two, we haven't lost very many.
Well, gone behind the wall now with apparently a blown engine on the car that we've been calling Raven Boats as a sponsor. Woodall Chevrolet in nearby Danville, Virginia, was also a co-sponsor on that car.
And there's another car that's behind the wall with a boat sponsor on it. That's a 90 car driven by Chad Little with Wahoo Boats.
Yeah, okay.
So the boat people are not having a good day in Martinsville.
But the attrition hasn't been all that high so far in this race. Everybody playing it rather conservatively. But Rusty Wallace able to maintain the lead over Dale Earnhardt and Alan Kulwicki and Darrell Waltrip. Wallace moving up on the number two car of Ernie Irvin once again. So you saw the entire field rundown now as the pit crews plan their strategy for the next stop, which should be coming up pretty soon. We'll be back in a moment. Something is wrong with Rusty Wallace's car. We see a big plume of blue smoke coming from underneath the car. He has lost the lead to Dale Earnhardt, and Rusty Wallace is coming in, it appears. Here's Jack Arute.
Well, Rusty Wallace should be making an appearance on pit road. Let's check with Harold Elliott, who's the engine man. What's the problem? What's Rusty radioing in?
Well, I think we just broke the valve, Jack. He wasn't running the car hard, so it wasn't turning excessive RPM, so I don't know. We've had a couple valve problems this year. I don't know. He was looking good today.
Well, they're very disappointed here, and they're waiting to see if Rusty is going to present himself on pit road. If he does, we'll be here. Back to you.
He continues to run on the racetrack, but it is a very slower pace that he is running compared to a few laps ago, as Rusty Wallace has had something go wrong with the race car, and he falls back now considerably. He's already been passed by four others, and Rusty Wallace is moving slowly. I thought he was going to come in for a stop that time. He does not. Continues to encircle the racetrack.
I tell you what. You talk about biting 20 penny nails into Rusty Wallace. And as we said just a moment ago, doing such a beautiful job taking care of the car. He might have used it a little bit trying to get by some of those guys, Earnhardt or Kulwicki, but he was really and truly taking care of the car. Now he just has to sit there and ride on seven cylinders and hope that it stays together all day long. Another 270 laps. And he's got to stay out there for the points because, folks, the Winston Cup Championship, the accumulation of all the points that you earn in all the 29 events, the winner at the end of the year receives $1 million.
Rusty did drop out of one race earlier this year with an engine problem. That was in Atlanta. He has finished the rest of the races, and he is trying to finish this one, but he's got almost half the race to go. And the blue smoke continues to pour from that race car. So at the moment, it is Dale Earnhardt who is leading this Winston Cup race here at Martinsville. The yellow is out on lap 275. Ricky Rudd has blasted into the front stretch wall coming out of corner number four. The car sits just below the starter stand, and it has been heavily damaged on the right side. There you can see it from the in-car camera as Ricky unstraps the belts and begins to extricate himself from that race car.
And Bob, he had made a very good run. He'd gotten himself up in fifth position. Dale Earnhardt is in the pits as expected here during this caution. And Jerry Punch is there.
It'll be a four-tire change, Ned, as Dale Earnhardt, Alan Kowicki, Hero Waltrip, all the lead cars are on pit road. They are hustling here in the Goodrich pits. Kowicki's crew doing an excellent job down changing tires. Left side car to Earnhardt. He's the first car off the jack. He is down and away. Kowicki is still in the pits now. Kowicki makes a move down pit road. There is Terry Labonte. Waltrip having trouble now. He has had trouble getting the jacks on the left side car. Jack Arute is there. Jack?
Well, there was a miscue here on pit road. Eddie Dickerson, who changes the right side tires first for Darrell Waltrip. He came around the front of Darrell Waltrip's car and tried to wave him on. What they had forgotten is they had loosened the left side lug nuts. Waltrip, showing a great deal of poise, did not take the cue and stayed in gear, but did not move away, and that could have been very costly. Shades of, the 94 car of Sterling Marlin back in Bristol. But he had a cooler head and gets back out there with four brand new tires.
Well, let's go back and take a look at what happened with the Ricky Rudd car. It had moved into fifth position, but then something went wrong and he went slamming into the fourth turn wall. Here it is.
Apparently a tire went down, just he might have cut it as he came. He was already on the straightaway and bam, right into the wall he goes.
And we have a look at it also from the in car.
He was following Greg Sachs down the front straightaway. Well, let's see, he's going into the turn now. That's going into turn three. We're watching. This is at speed as he comes off of turn four behind Greg Sachs and bam, right into the wall he goes, and he hits it hard.
He did hit it hard. We could see it. I saw it. We were talking about Rudd while we were on break and just what a great run he was having today. We looked at the car and boom, he blows a tire coming off the turn four. Cuts the tire down, does something.
Well, a tough break for the Kenny Bernstein-owned team as that car is lifted off of the racetrack and badly damaged. Let's go down to Jack Arute, who has to be a very disappointed Rusty Wallace.
Bob, disappointed he may be, but he's still trying to keep a stiff upper lip. Rusty, what really put you out? Harold Elliott said he thought it might be a severe engine problem.
Well, I think it's a drop valve. I'm not for sure. The guys are working real hard trying to get it fixed right now, and they're doing a good job at it. Just hope they can get something patched together so we can at least run in seven cylinders or something. It was really running super. I was just really kind of taking it easy, conserving the brakes and everything, and that's about it.
There was a lot of speculation up topside from Benny Parsons that you hadn't really even maybe used more than 80% of the car at any one time.
No, that's right. You know, this is a real aggressive racetrack, but it's a track that you really got to keep calm on so you don't tear the brakes up. And as if you notice, I was letting out of the gas every single lap at the start-finish line. And when I had to run somebody down or pass them, I'd drive it way down in there. I got a good brake pedal. The car handled excellent. And the guys did a wonderful job. We just got to figure this valve problem out. This is the second time now, and I know Harold's really working hard to try to figure it out.
Well, while they try to figure out a valve problem, there's a man that's scratching his head down with Jerry Punch, and that's Ricky Rudd. Jerry?
Pretty hard impact with the wall out of turn four, Ricky Rudd. Ricky, what happened up there?
Jerry, I don't know. It either blew a right front tire or a tire rod broke on the right side of the car. Just coming out of the corner, just made a hard right-hand corner, you know. And they're going to try to patch this Quaker State Buick up and get it back in. You know, we were just riding along, sort of saving brakes, running somewhere around 6th or 7th in a late lap and waiting for the end of the race, and it got there before we wanted it to.
Pretty encouraging starting back in the pack to be able to come to the front that quick, though.
Well, yeah, we were pleased with it. You know, the biggest thing, it takes a lot of patience here at Martinsville. We didn't want to get in too big a hurry and take a chance on getting in a wreck or using up the brakes. So we're just sort of taking our time, letting the race come to us, and it was starting to do so, and, you know, had an unfortunate thing happen to us like that.
We'll let Ricky move on. They're going to try to get the car patched up and get back on the speedway. That $1 million point bonus, very important. He needs to get back out. Bob?
All right, thank you. Only three drivers have had top 10 finishes in all three short track races this season. Rudd and Wallace among them. They both have problems here recently. We are back in Martinsville and just about to go green once again. The crew cam has been moved from Jimmy Cox to Mike Hill of the Budweiser team, the tire changer on that car, as he goes to work on the right rear.
Look at that precision work.
Moving around to the left side of the car. And we're going green as the race resumes after a crash involving Ricky Rudd here on the main straightaway. The lead held by Dale Earnhardt with Alan Kowicki running in second position. And in third now is Brett Bodine in car number 15. Fourth is Rick Wilson and fifth is Ken Schrader. We're riding with Harry Gant.
That's right. That's the camera inside of Harry Gant's goal. Bandit right behind Brett Bodine's Ford. Coming off the second corner down the back straightaway. Harry trying to get to the inside. Can't make it.
And a bit for the lead now. Alan Kowicki tries to take advantage of Dale Earnhardt. And Kowicki is loose coming out of four.
Well, he really got loose. He managed to hold on to it, but he lost three or four car lengths. And you see Terry Labonte right behind him. But Labonte had just gone a lap down before the caution came out.
There are seven cars on the lead lap, and Labonte is running in eighth position, one lap to the rear. Alan Kowicki did lose a little bit of ground in that attempt to take over the lead last lap, but did hold on to second.
This car looked like it slipped a little bit that time, Rob, as he came off of that fourth turn. Don't know if the turn slick or it looks like he's having a little bit of problem getting off of the turns. Earnhardt's moving away from him right now.
The number 25 car of Ken Schrader, the 84 car of Dick Trickle, and the 17 of Darrell Waltrip, all contesting positions here. Now, Dick Trickle has moved to fifth position. Schrader is sixth, and Waltrip is in seventh.
Just a moment ago, when Dick Trickle passed the 25 car driven by Ken Schrader, there was some pretty heavy damage. I mean, sheet metal swap between those two. As we see Trickle lose the back end just a little bit coming off turn four, trying to get the inside of Greg Saxon, the 88 car, couldn't make it.
Back up front, it is Earnhardt and Alan Kowicki. And we go down to Jerry Punch, who's in Alan Kowicki's pit.
Well, we saw Alan Kowicki having trouble in the corner trying to get the car turned. They do have a problem with the car. Let's find out what it is. Paul, what's the problem with the car?
Well, right now, he thinks he's got the toe end knocked out a little bit. It won't turn in the middle of the corner. We're going to probably ride this next green session out here. And if we feel like we need to, we'll go ahead and try to straighten it out.
They're going to try to get a lengthy caution flag. When we saw him earlier in the race, he bounced off that bright yellow curb and towed the left front tire out so it will not turn in the middle of the corner. He's having trouble getting back on the throttle. They're going to have to wait to fix it. Gentlemen?
A crash. Richard Petty's got off the racetrack over in turn two, but no caution flag. He was able to get the car going again, and no caution flag. Jerry Punch, I'll tell you what, knocked the toe end out on Alan Kowicki's car. He and Terry Labonte had some pretty heavy contact coming off turn two on the restart. That's where he got the toe end knocked at.
And here's the replay of Richard Petty sideways in the grass and the dirt coming out of turn number two.
But he gets it righted and keeps going. He's way back in the back of the pack. Of course, Richard Petty is many laps down for any fans that might have just joined us. He had a problem earlier in the race when he blew a tire and was out for repairs for quite a while, but back in there with the STP Pontiac.
Jeff Hammond looking on as his driver, Darrell Waltrip, is struggling in the field. Jack Arut is with Jeff Hammond.
Bob, you know how they say races can be won or lost in the pits? Well, a malfunction and a miscue have really been costly. Jeff Hammond is also the jack man on the team. And, Jeff, you had a jack go down when you were changing those right side tires.
Yeah, Jack, I don't know exactly what happened, but I believe we blew the seal out, but the car started up and all of a sudden stopped going up. So I had to call for the other backup jack, and the guys did a good job getting around there, but put us way back in the packs, and now we got to work a little bit harder to get back to the front.
Now, the difference between the new jack that he was using is about 30 pounds. He's going back to his old jack, and that weighs about 60 pounds. So he's not can't sling it. He's got to carry it. And on top of all that, they had already removed the lug nuts from the left side tires, and they almost went pulling out of pit road without them. But he had enough wherewithal, that is Darrell Waltrip, to stay on pit road. They exchanged the four tires. He's back, but he's way, way back.
Well, there's a 57 car up in the wall in turn one and two, but he has the car moving again. I don't know. Caution flag is still not out. The car's still moving.
It's moving slowly. We're watching Harold Kinder to see whether or not he's going to throw the caution.
Yes.
And the car stops.
Boy, he's sitting in a bad position because those cars always go out at that spot as they come off of that turn, but it looks like most of them are going to be able to get by.
So Hunt Strickland in car number 57 brings out the fourth caution period of the afternoon here at Martinsville with Dale Earnhardt still on the top. We'll be right back. Caution is out in Martinsville because of a spin and contact with the wall over in turn number two involving Hut Strickland, and it appears as if neither Dale Earnhardt nor Alan Kulwicki will make pit stops during this caution period. Earnhardt staying out on the track. Darrell Waltrip is one of those making a pit stop. Jack Arute will call the Darrell Waltrip pit stop.
Well, Darrell Waltrip's crew, led by Jeff Hammond, has gone to work. This time, the jack works nicely. They dropped the jack. They've changed the right side tires. Now, Jeff carrying the car, carrying the jack around for the first time. He goes to the left sides as well. They've already removed all the lug nuts. Eddie Dickerson makes the change, and then they make the change on the left side.
Maintains on the lead lap. He was shown as the last car on the lead lap in seventh position before that stop, and I think he will pretty much maintain that position.
I guess I better explain. To those people that work in a garage or know what a floor jack costs, and they say that's not right, he isn't correct. Folks, every piece in the jack is handmade, except the power unit, the thing that ruptured the seal. Now, that's a factory-made piece, but every part of the frame is. Oh, Darrell Waltrip is on pit road.
With the hood up.
With the hood up. Jackaroo.
They go to work on Darrell Waltrip's car. The hood is up, but we were going to show you the jack that malfunctioned here. As you said, Benny, the reason for the high expense is because it's so light. Now, they use a lot of space-age materials. You can see they drill all the holes, and they get it. And here is the seal right down in here that failed. Now, what Jeff Hammond has done is gone back to a conventional floor jack, and the only change that they've made there is in the number of strokes you need to get up off the ground. The irony to all this, this is the first time this year that Hammond tried this new $1,200 jack.
So the green is about to come back out now in just a couple of moments. We will stay with the race action here as we await the cars to go back to a green flag situation. The pace car pulls off the track on the backstretch, and the pace begins to quicken.
Elmo Langley, the pace car driver, pulled off the racetrack, and Earnhardt hit the accelerator and was just trying to clear the engine out, but Harry Gant hit the accelerator too. He said, Earnhardt, I'm going where you go. Because Harry Gant right now has an opportunity to get his lap back. Harry Gant on the inside, the green and white car. Dale Earnhardt, the leader, the black number three.
Green flag comes out on lap 299. Earnhardt leads him down the backstretch once again with Kulwicki in pursuit.
Well, you know, it's sort of surprising that Kulwicki didn't come in during that caution. Paul Anderson, his crew chief, said that he might come in to check it out, but he didn't, so apparently it got to work a little bit better for him.
You know, Ned, I had forgotten about that, but that is confusing because he felt like he had a toe-in problem.
Big group of cars running behind the leaders here, including the number 15 car of Brett Bodine, as it is now in third position. There is Brett following his brother, Wilson, in car number four. Rick Wilson has done a fine job. We haven't talked about him very much during the telecast, but he is in fourth position and doing very, very well out there. Sterling Marlin right behind him in fifth. And then there's Dick Trickle in car number 84, who is sixth.
I think Sterling Marlin is a lap down in the car number 94, so that would put Trickle in the fifth position.
It is the 84 that is in the fifth position and not Marlin in 94.
There we see the Darrell Waltrip car right on the right side of the screen. We saw him. There he is on the right side of the screen. He was one of the only cars to make a pit stop on that last caution flag, and yet he's back up in the hunt already. Darrell Waltrip's car still running well.
He made two pit stops, as a matter of fact. That second time, the hood went up on the car.
Yeah, I think they just made some slight adjustment on there. I don't think there's any major problem whatsoever. And look at him. He just moved going to turn three on the inside of the car number 25. And four more on that 17 car and that extra pit stop. Let's go to Jackaroo.
Well, Ned, what you thought is absolutely true. You know, they had the problem they thought with the right front. They thought a tire was going down. But when they came in the last time, they discovered that the car was actually bottoming out. That's why it came back in. They raised the hood, and they, in essence, raised the right front of the car just a bit. And it seems to have cured all of their problems.
He is running well now right up on the back bumper of Dick Trickle, car number 84. Trickle, who is in fifth position. And the 17 car of Waltrip in sixth. Here's Darrell moving to the inside of Dick Trickle at the end of the backstretch. He may have got the position. He indeed did go into fifth place. So Darrell Waltrip is not out of the contest by any means. Well, our Napa race summary shows that Dale Earnhardt had led the 64 out of the first 300 laps at an average speed of 77.829 miles an hour. 5 leaders, 8 different lead changes, 4 caution periods for a total of 24 laps, and 7 cars at the moment are on the lead lap. The leaders so far have been Jeff Bodine from the pole position. Then he became involved in an incident up in turn number 4. Darrell Waltrip has led, so has Alan Kowicki, Rusty Wallace, who is now behind the wall, and Dale Earnhardt. Also out of the race, besides Rusty Wallace, Chad Little, Rick Mast, Ricky Rudd because of an accident, and Hut Strickland is the most recent to go behind the wall. He had a problem up there in turn number 2 and has pulled into his pit on the backstretch. Now we see Harry Gant in car number 33 challenging Dale Earnhardt. This isn't for position. Harry is trying to get his lap back and is moving quite well. Now behind all of this, the number 17 car of Darrell Waltrip and the 4 car of Rick Wilson are battling.
Well, Darrell just went around Rick Wilson a lap ago, so he is still on the move.
One advantage that Darrell Waltrip does have right now is he changed tires. And there we see Harry Gant on the 33 car trying to get alongside Earnhardt, and I believe he has him.
I believe he's going to do it. They go into the corner side by side.
And a spin coming off turn 4.
Well, Bill Elliott is in trouble coming off of turn 4. And Harry Gant, he can get back to the start-finish line.
No caution,
so I don't guess it'll matter.
Well, let's see if Bill Elliott gets the car stopped. He pulls into the pit, so there will be no reason for the caution. And the green stays out. So Bill Elliott does make some severe contact with the wall.
There's some liquid on the racetrack.
Oh, and Larry Gibson hits it and spins.
There's a lot of liquid on the racetrack.
I expect it bursted the radiator on Bill Elliott's car. And as they come off of there, look, Harry Gant almost loses it.
It
sure did, but he stayed in the lead lap. So this is a break for him.
Several cars are having a tough time moving through that water on the racetrack, but only Larry Pearson became a victim of it as he spun and hit the inside wall. You can see, though, very evident that water there on the inside of the racetrack.
Yeah, right to the left of Larry Pearson's car. You can see where Elliott came down through there. There is liquid there that should have been seen, but they figured maybe it didn't happen until he got down out of the groove.
Well, there is a reason for the caution, as Elliott had the accident up there in turn number 4, and so the caution is flagged. And look at the action on pit road as most of those who are running up front have come in, including Dale Earnhardt and Alan Kowicki. Let's go to Jerry Punch and Earnhardt's pit.
Quick tire change going on here. Earnhardt on the top of your screen, Alan Kowicki on the bottom of your screen. Earnhardt's crew now coming to the left side of the Goodrich Chevrolet. They are now loosening the left side lugs in the Z-Rex Ford for Alan Kowicki. Earnhardt's crew now, left front tire, left rear tire on. Down off the jack is Dale Earnhardt. Kowicki still on the jack, and they are getting ready, still on the jack. Now off the jack for Kowicki. He will follow Jeff Bodine down pit road.
So Kowicki moving back out onto the racetrack. And there is the number 17 car of Darrell Waltrip, as it did not make a pit stop and is at the moment in the lead of this race. Well, the way in which oil is cooled in these cars has changed recently. We get the information in our track fact. Here is Gary Nelson. Track facts are brought to you by Quaker State Motor Oil. The big Q stands for quality. Always has, always will.
You're looking at the rear end cooler. Its job is to cool the oil from the rear end. There's an air scoop under the car, picks up the air from the airstream, blows it down through that cooler to keep the oil cool. Now this is a cooler. The oil flows in this end and out the other. This is the old way we used to cool it. It's a squirrel cage motor driven by an electric motor. Now, the new way is to have an air scoop under the car, picking up air from the airstream, blowing the air down through here. The faster the car goes, the more air flows through here, the cooler the rear end gets. But also, the faster the car goes, the more heat is generated by the gears in the rear end, so it balances out much better than the old electric fan.
All kinds of innovations in Winston Cup racing. And here at Martinsville in the Pannill Sweatshirts 500, Darrell Waltrip now has the lead, and we'll be back after this. Welcome back to Martinsville, Virginia Speedway for Winston Cup Racing on this Sunday afternoon. Today, the Pannill Sweatshirts 500. Our Speed World coverage is being brought to you by Budweiser Beechwood Age for that clean, crisp taste. This Bud's for you. By the Heartbeat of America, today's Chevrolet. And by Kubota Tractor Corporation. See your Kubota dealer today. Martinsville, Virginia Speedway under caution because of a crash involving Bill Elliott down in turn number four. Jerry Punch is there.
Well, Ernie Elliott working on the course, melling forward, trying to rebuild the front end a little bit, and we're here with Bill Elliott still sitting in the car. Bill, what happened up there?
Well, Dale Jarrett spun out, and he just did a 360, and I started on the high side, and then when I got to him, you know, I was coming on, you know, and the way NASCAR's got the cautions now, they're not going to throw a caution for a spin. You know, when I slowed down, then I said, okay, he's going to be all right, and then I got back in the throttle, and then when I started on the round, you know, I was in line with him, and when I came through the smoke, I couldn't see him, and then I hit him in the back.
Bill Elliott still sitting in the car. They're going to try to get the car fixed and get the reigning Winston Cup champion back out to pick up some more points. Let's go up to Jackaroo. Jack?
Well, Jerry, one team that's not going to try and get their car back out, he's already changed into his street clothes, is Larry Pearson. Larry, what happened out there?
Well, when Dale Jarrett spun out there, I think Bill Elliott got into him and knocked a hole in the oil cooler or something, and he had all the way down the front straightaway and down through turns one and two, and evidently NASCAR didn't see the oil or something, but a caution should definitely have been thrown. They told us at the driver's meeting, you know, that they were going to not throw the caution flag unless it was absolutely necessary, you know, a spin out or something like that, and if a guy kept going, then they wouldn't throw the caution, but...
It's a tough one. It definitely was a tough one. No question about that. We're about ready to go back to green flag racing, so we're going to go back topside.
All right. Thank you, Jack. And here comes the field off the fourth corner as the race resumes on lap number 320. Look at everybody scramble to get around Michael Waltrip, whose car just didn't go when the green came out, and they went right and left and everywhere to try to get around him.
Yeah, he was lucky. He didn't really get tagged hard. He was right in the center of the pack.
Here is... the in-car camera of Michael Waltrip. He's got the car pretty much up to speed right now and behind Dale Jarrett in the Hardy's car.
You know, it doesn't look like there's that much damage to the rear of Dale Jarrett's car as much as was done to Bill Elliott's car.
Ben Hess now positions himself between Waltrip and Dale Jarrett as Michael tries to go to the high side of Ben Hess.
Well, the rear of these cars are pretty strong. We see the rear of the 30 car doesn't look too strong, but the rear of these cars really and truly are pretty strong. But the front of the cars are not that strong because it's just basically sheet metal or even fiberglass and aluminum up there. There's nothing really to protect that radiator. Never see Michael Waltrip wave his hand. He's going in the pits.
Yeah, something wrong with the car, and he was motioning to the drivers behind him that he was taking the car into the backstretch pits, and that's exactly where he is right now. He comes to a stop, and the crew will raise the hood and go in there, perhaps, maybe just getting the debris and the rubber off the front end of the radiator of the car.
Brett Bodine now putting a little bit of pressure on Dale Earnhardt.
Brett Bodine
running second.
Yeah, in third position. Bodine there in the number 15 car. That's Darrell Waltrip leading, Dale Earnhardt second, and there are the Bodine brothers. It is Brett in third position now in a fine run in the Budmore Motorcraft for Thunderbird. Started 15th. Moved to 13th at the end of 100 laps. By the end of 225 circuits, he was ninth and now finds himself in third position. That's brother Jeff right behind, but remember, Jeff is not on the lead lap, having suffered some body damage in a crash early in the race. And here is Bobby Hillen Jr.'s car as they are trying to extinguish a fire in the engine compartment of that machine. The smoke begins to clear away.
Apparently the fire is out as they have the deck lid or the hood raised on the car.
Meanwhile, for fourth position, we see the number four car of Rick Wilson, the 84 of Dick Trickle, and the 33 of Harry Gant. Now remember, as we go inside Harry Gant's car, he is back on the lead lap and finds himself sixth.
He got the car.
extremely
sideways just a moment ago coming off turn four. I can't see if he made any contact with a wall or not, but the car, Harry Gant's car, not too good right now. Looks a little squirrely.
Yeah, he's getting a little bit high in the turn, so Benny. Greg Sachs slows over on the back stretch in car number 88. Let's see if Gant does hit the wall. Here he comes off of the turn, coming up from the other cars, and yeah, he does hit the wall. No wonder that he slowed down there for at least one lap.
So Harry Gant has a handful now, as we'll watch him maneuver the car around the corners. You can see that the car just isn't handling very well.
Well, he's back up to speed pretty good right now, Bob. That slowed him for a little bit. You see the back end of that car from an earlier accident. And of course, the hitting the wall there tore the bumper loose a little bit more. But he's moving around a little bit. But I'll tell you one thing. If anybody can drive an ill-handling race car, it is Harry Gant.
I was going to say he's a tough old guy, but I better not do that since he's about my age. So,
yeah, you don't have any room to talk. No. Except you're not driving it.
And look here, Dale Earnhardt has caught the car number 17 of Darrell Waltrip. Remember, Earnhardt made a pit stop on this last caution. Darrell Waltrip did not.
And Bill Elliott returns to the racetrack for Winston Cup points. You can see how there is some damage on the left front of that race car. However, they have gotten the bodywork pulled away from the tire and repairs made after he made contact down in turn number four. And Bill Elliott is back in the race. Meanwhile, it is still Darrell Waltrip who is leading with Dale Earnhardt pursuing very, very closely in second. We'll be back with more from Martinsville after this. NASCAR Racing Winston Cup Division at Martinsville, Virginia Speedway for the Pannill Sweatshirts 500 on this Sunday afternoon. Our leader is Darrell Waltrip in car number 17. Running in second position is Dale Earnhardt. Well, we talked about the tire story at the very opening of the show and how everybody, or most everybody, was starting on the Goodyears. Jack, are we seeing in today's race what we have seen in previous races? That is a bidding war for those that have already dropped out of competition?
Bob, you know, just south of here in North Carolina, they have tobacco auctions. And they get really talking fast, and it goes to the highest bidder. Absolutely, we're having a bidding war down here on pit road again. No sooner does a car crash or pull out than there's four, five, maybe six tire runners in different pit from different pit crews right there at the pit saying, can we have your tires? We'll buy them. We'll take them. They're shuffling sets back and forth. And the interesting thing, though, is the man that seems to be coming up the loser from my end of the pit time and time again with this problem is the runner from Alan Kulwicki's team. He's always a day late or a dollar short. The top teams are getting sets. In fact, Darrell Waltrip just received a set from none other than the Winston Cup champion, Bill Elliott. See the number nine in the gold rims? They'll look kind of funny on that Tide machine. Let's check in with Jerry Punch.
Jack, we want to update the Alan Kulwicki story. Of course, he is not getting tires like he would like to as Brett Bodine is slowing on the racetrack. We are seeing in turn one, Bodine in the Motorcraft Ford of Bud Moore's car is pulling down on the line and slowing drastically in turn two. But Kulwicki, they have made the adjustment on the tow end on that last pit stop. It was towed out about a half an inch. They towed it back in, but he was mired back in traffic. And so he is certainly back in heavy traffic as Brett Bodine pulls that car behind the wall. And we'll follow up on that story in just a moment. Bob?
All right, thank you. So Alan Kulwicki now will move into seventh position as Brett Bodine drops from competition. A tough break for Brett, whose Motorcraft Ford was running so well in third position, and then suddenly something happened to the car, and he was behind the wall. The lead is held by Darrell Waltrip, and Earnhardt is second. Rick Wilson now goes to third, and look at the back bumper on the Harry Gant car.
Yeah, it's really waving in the wind. Now, while we were away on the commercial break, Dale Jarrett had a similar situation. They black flagged him. He lost a lap pulling that off. Gant doesn't seem to be, yeah, they're giving him the black flag right now, so Harry Gant's going to have to come in to get that bumper pulled off.
The battle scar showing on the 33 Skoal Bandit of Harry Gant. Now, he was on the lead lap, but is going to have to come in and get that back bumper torn off.
He was a lap down earlier in the race, fought his way back, got back in the lead lap, but now getting the black flag, pulled to the inside, so he'll be pulling into the pits next time around and get that bumper taken away.
Well, it's definitely been uphill all day for Harry Gant. You're right, he raced hard, got the lap back, now the bumpers on the back of the sheet metal, I don't know if it's a bumper or what it is, but something's hanging back there. Now that you can see them with a hammer trying their best to get it knocked off.
They needed a bigger hammer, Ben.
Yeah, they did.
Boy, isn't it amazing how they spend millions and millions of dollars in the wind tunnel each year to get these cars aerodynamically tuned, and that's what happens. You take the sledgehammer to them. There's a leader, Darrell Waltrip. Now, Jack Arute is down in the pit area with Brett Bodine. Fine run for Brett, but unfortunately, things have gone wrong. Jack?
Brett, after a terrific day, what put you out?
Well, something happened to the motor, Jackie. It hadn't been really running right the last 150 laps, and I don't know what happened. It dropped the valve or something. I don't know what we got to do. We really got a good race team, and that's the way it goes.
How is it psychologically on a driver such as yourself when you've had so many good runs? You win a pole, you do so well, and you're still coming up short.
That's tough. You know, but we're a good race team. We're going to be back next week. We're going to run just as good. Someday we're going to be there. That's all there is to it.
They say that these type of days build character. I think you'd be hard-pressed to convince Brett Bodine of that today.
Well, Brett certainly did a fine job yesterday afternoon. I hope you were with us for the Raven Boats 150 NASCAR Modified Tour Race. He was outstanding up here in the booth as a color commentator. And, of course, that race was won by Mike Stefanik. Brett Bodine doing a fine job on the racetrack today, but then things went wrong. Harry Gant has returned to the racetrack in the number 33 car. They have torn that bumper away and put a Band-Aid on the car, and so he's back out there. And we look out the back glass of the Skull Bandit toward the number 4 car of Rick Wilson and the 84 car of Dick Trickle and the 25 of Ken Schrader and the 7 of Alan Kowicki. This is the battle for third position. Rick Wilson and Dick Trickle.
Now they're pretty far behind the leader, Darrell Waltrip. In fact, that's about as far as we've seen third position behind the leader. He's about almost half a lap behind.
I tell you what, Waltrip is out there, and his tires had 15 or 20 laps on them after this caution flag. And he is driven away from Earnhardt, or he's driving away from Earnhardt. It's very impressive. Dick Trickle, there's also Rick Wilson in the orange car, Dick Trickle in the golden white car, another two drivers. Super run for both of them today.
Dick Trickle's car appears to be pretty loose as he's almost spun there a couple of times coming off the corner.
Now, his fourth place has got him, Bob, don't you understand? He wants to pass that four car, get to third place.
Schrader, meanwhile, and Kowicki are right there behind Trickle.
But really and truly, I think right now Dick Trickle is a little faster than Rick Wilson, and he wants by because he knows if he's going to win, he's got to get by because the leaders, Earnhardt and Waltrip, driving away.
Trickle has been in such a great position in the late stages of so many races this year to not necessarily win the race, but I'll tell you, this guy has really turned some heads in Winston Cup competition.
There he goes on the inside of Wilson. Down the back straightaway, he's got position.
Side by side into three. Yes, indeed, Dick Trickle's got him.
I think Rick backed off once he knew that he had him and said there's no point in me racing him into this turn, taking any kind of an extra chance. And Jack Arute is down there in the pit of Rick Wilson.
And the man that you're looking at is the man that they say accounts for the big change in Rick Wilson's operation this year, Sheldon Runt Pittman, who left Haas Ellingham when Haas ceased operation and is now working with this team. Runt, what is Rick saying on the radio? The car seems to be running methodically well up front.
Well, he's just trying to stay where he is right now and save the car for the end of the race.
When do you guys figure you'll begin to race?
About the last 100 laps.
100 laps, that's when we'll look for the move further up to the front by the Kodak film team.
Well, we keep waiting for the end of the race, so to speak. We're on lap 362, and I would think before too long, maybe in the next 60 or so laps, drivers are going to be thinking about going for it now, and we'll begin to see some things that perhaps we haven't seen earlier in the race. Well, Martinsville Speedway dates all the way back to the 40s. It opened back in 1949. A little bit of history in this week's Winston Cup replay. Clay Earls continues to put money into this racetrack, making improvements. Remember, there used to be a top over the grandstand here on the main straightaway. That's been eliminated, and they've also built a brand new broadcast booth for us here at ESPN. 370 laps completed at Martinsville out of 500 in the Pannill Sweatshirts 500. Darrell Waltrip is the leader. Moments ago, it was Ken Schrader in number 25 and Alan Kowicki in number 7 duking it out for position.
Well, Schrader in the 25 car gets bumped by Kowicki, gets bumped again, and goes high. Kowicki goes by on the inside, or attempts to. Looks like he is going to be able to make the pass. And here comes Mark Martin by as well in the car number 6.
And into the next corner, guess what? The 25 of Schrader got back by Kowicki. So.
Yeah, I think they were told in the driver's meeting, if you bump somebody, get them out of position, you better let them pass you back, or we're going to bring you into pits.
Oh,
so
okay.
I think that's what happened there. They probably warned him down there and said, okay, you better back off and let him back in front of you and then go at it again.
So Schrader maintains 5th and Kowicki 6th place.
And while we were... but you know, Kowicki can't catch Schrader right now. And look, there's a... the leader, Darrell Waltrip, and we'll look right behind, well, not quite, 3 or 4 cars behind him is the 33, Harry Gant. Yes, he got by Earnhardt just a couple of laps ago. I was hesitant to say anything about it because we weren't seeing it on the screen. But look, right here behind Darrell Waltrip, Harry Gant trying to get that lap back once again.
This guy has been amazing. He lost a lap, got it back. He lost a lap again when he had to go into the pits to get the bumper torn off the car. And now here he is trying to get back on the lead lap again.
He didn't know which side of Morgan Shepherd to go on. He didn't know if he should follow him through on the low side, go on the high side. He made 2 different moves there, finally moved on the outside of him. Lost a little bit of time there to Darrell Walter, but the way he's going right now, he'll be able to pick that back up because he's flying.
You see, Bob, you see the right hand of Harry Gant? You notice anything strange about it? It doesn't have a glove on.
No glove, yeah, I noticed that earlier.
This is Harry Gant. Some of the older guys, Richard Petty, doesn't wear gloves. Harry Gant, they just don't like them. They want that feel of that steering wheel. They want to know exactly what that car is doing, and they feel like that a gloves hurts that feel.
Well, Gant is closing in on the leader, Darrell Waltrip, to try to gain his lap back. You can see Darrell there just a few car lengths ahead as Waltrip has Jeff Bodine in front of him, and Darrell has had a struggle to put another lap on Jeff. Now Jeff moving high on the track in turn number 4 and allowing Darrell to pass underneath. And the 25 and 7 car continue to battle it out. Schrader and Kowicki. Looks like Allen may have him on the inside in turn 3. And Kowicki momentarily to 5th. Oh, great race.
Kowicki gets it sideways coming off turn 4. That car not handling nearly as well as it has been earlier in the day.
Good clean pass that time, though. He shouldn't have to let him back by.
No. We're sitting beside a NASCAR limit. No, Dick Beatty didn't jump up, so I guess everything is okay.
And Harry Gant now is right on the back bumper of Waltrip. Let's see if Harry can get a lap back again.
Look at him drive up on the rear bumper of Waltrip, coming off turn 4. Right up on the rear bumper, looks on the inside. Nope, spot covered.
Well, Darrell knows that he's back there, and I'm sure that his crew has informed him, hey, that car is flying. He's trying to get back in the lead lap. Darrell might have to punish his car a little bit more here than he wants to at this point of the race, just to keep Harry Gant back there and to come up on Neil Bynum in the 604 to put another lap on him.
Now let's see if Harry can get himself to the inside of Walter. He'll have to go high on the track to pass Neil Bynum in the 21 car. Does so in turn number 3, although he's alongside of Neil.
Tell you what, it is tough to pass on the outside because there just isn't any room out there.
Not racing room. Lots of room out there, but not
yes.
Good traction.
As you two discovered earlier.
I think Darrell Waltrip's going to do his best to try to keep Harry Gant back there because he knows that if a caution should come out, that Gant being back in the lead lap as fast as he's running could be trouble. Now, we also have to remember that Harry Gant put on 2 right side tires when they pulled that bumper off, and so that has helped him a little bit. Let's go to the pits in Jackaroo.
Well, Ned, it's absolutely the opposite of what we're surmising. I checked with Jeff Hammond, the crew chief on Darrell Waltrip's team, and they said they've discussed it, and they've decided not to use any more of the car up than they have to. They're not concerned about Harry. They said if Harry can get by, that'll be fine. They say he's used up a lot of the race car in trying to come back to the front. They said we'd rather save a little for later rather than try and hold him off now. So if Harry can get a good, clean move on Darrell, he'll be by because Darrell's not going to fight him too hard.
That'll be interesting to see because he sure looks like he's fighting to keep him back there. He's done a good job of it so far, but maybe he doesn't have to fight to do that. Maybe the car just working that well, but he doesn't have to punish it as Darrell puts another lap on his brother, Michael Walton.
Tell you what's happened. I think Harry Ginn in his, oh, there, Michael Walton going back in the pits again. We see him holding his hand up, watching the car go down. There's the pit board, telling the car where to stop. Michael comes to a stop. Crew's changing the right side, cleaning the windshield, cleaning all the debris off the front of the car. Also, that guy in the rear is adjusting the chassis on the automobile. Did a quick lemonade. Michael walks away.
Michael back out in the race, and look how tight it is as you go out of the pits. You enter in the groove, and you've got to really be careful.
You really do. Well, he lost exactly a lap. Darrell had just gone around him before he came into the pit, so he lost exactly a lap on that pit stop.
I was talking just a moment ago about Harry again, and it looks to me like that Harry, trying desperate to get by Darrell Walter, got his tires a little bit too hot. We can see now he's lost three or four car lengths to Walter. Oh! Mikey got the car sideways. Whew. Off turn four.
Whew. He had his hands full saving that. Much smoother coming out of the corner this time as he heads down the backstretch. So Michael Waltrip's brother, Darrell Waltrip, continues to lead at the end of 387 laps in the 500-lap Pannill Sweatshirts 500. Martinsville Speedway in Virginia, the scene of ESPN Speed World on this Sunday afternoon, the Pannill Sweatshirts 500. Darrell Waltrip is leader of the race, and moments ago, Alan Kowicki, who was running in the top five, came in, and liquid was pouring out of the back end of that race car.
Of course, they go under the hood to see if they can see anything wrong there, but apparently it's a cracked head or some sort of an inside of the engine problem, and let's find out exactly what is wrong. Jerry Punch is there.
Well, Ned, they're behind the wall, and Alan has climbed out of the Xerox Ford. Alan, they're working on the car. What's the problem?
Well, it seems to be the same problem we had at Bristol. The hub came off the water pump.
You're going to be able to fix it and get you back out?
Probably, but we've lost a lot of time here in the meantime. You know, it pretty much ruined our day for us.
A man who is only 9 points out of the Winston Cup lead has another bad break here at Martinsville. He's going to try to get back out, but he's going to lose a lot of valuable time and points. Gentlemen?
Those Winston Cup points are really, really tight. As I mentioned earlier, the top four are separated by only 30, with, of course, Earnhardt in the lead and Jeff Bodine second. Jeff's going to lose position probably because of the fact that he was involved in that early race altercation. And Darrell Waltrip, who was fifth going into this race and is leading at the moment, stands to gain some Winston Cup points if he should continue to hang on to that lead. Now, still right behind Darrell is the 33 car of Harry Gant, and Harry has not yet been able to regain that lap that he lost a few minutes ago, but he sure is giving it all he's got.
Now's his best shot because Darrell Waltrip is just heavy traffic. We see Darrell Farn and Phil Parsons, Bill Elliott, and Harry Gant right behind him. Michael Waltrip undoing his helmet. That's not a good sign.
He's pitted on the backstretch, and it looks as if he is going to climb out of that car and call it a day. We go back inside Gant's car now.
It's Ricky Rudd, who is many laps down, moves to the high side of the racetrack, gives them the good groove to run on.
And we see right behind Ricky Rudd is Dale Earnhardt. Now, he is not a lap down. He's in the same lap as Darrell Waltrip and just three or four car lengths behind him.
You know, seeing that Dawn there on the back of Darrell's car as a sub-sponsor on that machine. Dawn is one of the things that is being used to clean the animals from Alaska who have become involved in that oil situation, and Dawn liquid detergent is being used to clean them. The complete field rundown now at the end of 400 laps. You can see that Trickle is hanging in there in fourth position, and Gant in sixth is the first car that is not on the lead lap. Five on the lead lap at the moment. At Phil Parsons ahead of the 17 car of Waltrip, as Phil shown in 10th at the moment. So the laps are winding down now. We've got less than 100 to go in this race, as 406 officially are in the books. And there you can see now that Dale Earnhardt has closed in somewhat on Darrell Waltrip, and as a matter of fact is right behind this car driven by Harry Gann.
Darrell still there. We looked in the back. That's Earnhardt. As we looked out the rear window, the Goodwin Chevrolet right on the back bumper of Harry Gann.
Perhaps just poised and waiting for the last few laps of this race before Dale Earnhardt makes the move. These first two are probably almost a full straightaway ahead of the third place car of Dick Trickle and the fourth place car of Britt Wilson. And the average speed at the end of 400 laps was 77.714 miles an hour. Not quite a race record. The record here, 78.119, set by Waltrip in 78.
Once again, out the back window of Harry Gann's car, Dale Earnhardt comes out on the inside, right up on the back bumper of Harry. Harry gets back on the gas, a few car lengths ahead. And as we can see, right in front of Darrell Waltrip, Phil Parsons, he's looking on the inside. Couldn't get by. Harry Gann closes up.
So for the moment, this situation settles down here as Earnhardt continues to run in second position, separated from the leader, Darrell Waltrip, by this car that we are riding in, Harry Gann, as we look out the back glass once again to see how close Earnhardt can pull down on that Gant car. And there it is from the grandstand view. Well, Jack Arude has a look now at our pit notes. This is a recap of what's happened here at Martinsville Speedway since we arrived on Friday.
For the first time in history, in an effort to cut down costs for competitors, there was no activity here on Thursday at Martinsville Speedway, but on Friday the activity was hot and heavy. Jeff Bodine took his Richmond car that planked him on the pole there and put it on the pole here in Martinsville. The King was back. Richard Petty qualifying 17th, breaking the track record. But he was only one of 18 cars that eclipsed the track records. Unbelievable qualifying in the first round. Bill Elliott, Morgan Shepherd, Davey Allison, Sterling Marlin, and Ricky Rudd would have to wait until Saturday to make it into the race. On Saturday, Mike Stefanik led the men that live by the grace of God and 600 horsepower, the Mod Squad, to Martinsville. He bested a fast-closing Reggie Ruggiero. Ruggiero, with an overheating problem, could not get by Stefanik. Stefanik takes the win in the Raven 150. And the big story in late afternoon qualifying, the fact that there were no more tires to be had from the Goodyear Tire Store. All of them were mounted, and drivers and teams waited for race day on Sunday, hopefully with enough tires.
That was a recap of the activity prior to the start of the race, and now you can see that Dale Earnhardt has passed Harry Gann, and Earnhardt is now making a bid to take over the lead as Waltrip is involved in some heavy race traffic. Ahead of him is Bill Elliott. He passes the two car of Ernie Irvin, and let's see what happens here. We may have a change of leadership. Three abreast racing down the backstretch as Waltrip goes to the inside of Bill Elliott, and here comes Earnhardt also. A battle for the lead, shaping up. Can Waltrip hold off the challenge of Earnhardt? He's been able to do so for the moment.
Bill Elliott gave him plenty of running room, backed off for Earnhardt so he could get down on the low side of the groove. And boy, look how close he is running.
Looks like he may be pushing Darrell. Earnhardt will try him high, maybe.
Well, that's the long, hard way around. Doesn't quite work that time, but he does keep a nose up alongside. When he goes into turn one, he'll be able to pull up beside of him.
Ooh, boy, sure look at this. Does. That car has some power. He's been able to make the move on the outside of the racetrack and drives around Darrell Waltrip. Earnhardt is the leader.
Wow, that was impressive.
Well, we've been talking about how drivers have been saving their cars for the late stages of the race. I think we're probably here. We've got just a little more than 80 laps to go. Now, we mentioned that in the pit notes that Richard Petty made the field. Indeed, he did. He was involved in a bit of an altercation earlier, but is back out on the racetrack. Here's Jerry Punch with more.
Well, it's not a good day for Richard Petty, but it has been a good week for the STP crew. The reason being that Robert Calicutt, the driver who was burned in Atlanta, Georgia, came home this week from the Burns Center in Augusta, came to his home in Ashburn, North Carolina. Now, Robert is home tonight watching this event from Martinsville Speedway, and all the drivers and crew members here have asked that we say hello and wish a very speedy recovery to Robert Calicutt, who was burned in Atlanta, and we wish him to come back with us soon. Robert, hope you get well soon from all of us at ESPN and all the competitors here at NASCAR.
And certainly those of us in the booth second that notion. So the lead now has been taken over by Dale Earnhardt as we are 80 laps away from the end of this 500-lapper here at Martinsville. We're glad you could join us on this Sunday for Winston Cup Racing, and we'll be right back. Here's a closer look at the area beyond the gates of Martinsville Speedway. We're located south of Roanoke and west of Norfolk, Virginia Beach, and Richmond. As we exit the gate, you'll find the usual concession and souvenir stand surrounding Martinsville Speedway. The dogwoods and the azaleas are in full bloom in the foothills of the Blue Ridge Mountains of Virginia. The Speedway, known for its exciting racing, is also famous for the Duck Pond, which is just beyond the gates in turn number 4. Agriculture is one of the industries in the area, but the largest is textiles. The Henry County Government Office Building is named for once resident Patrick Henry. The Henry County Hydroelectric Plant is located on Highway 220, just a couple of miles from the track, and supplies power to the entire area. Martinsville, Virginia, rich in natural beauty and in recreation. And as you saw on the map, we're just west of Norfolk, Virginia. That brings to mind, of course, tomorrow the arrival of the USS Iowa. Certainly our thoughts are with the victims of that terrible disaster on the ship and those that are surviving. At the racetrack itself, it is still Dale Earnhardt and Darrell Waltrip running in first and second position. We should be seeing some pit stops coming up here, and there you can see the record. Since 1983, the Monte Carlo has won 10 of 12 races here at Martinsville, and they are running first and second here this afternoon. It looks like the Monte Carlo could go out in style. This is its final race.
Well, it certainly is in good position right now. And you're right, Bob. They should have pit stops coming up, I believe, in the next 10 to 20 laps. They certainly will have to make another one before this race is over. They got about 6 to 7 laps to go.
While we were in break, the 25 car of Ken Schrader went a lap down. So now there are only 4 on the lead lap: Earnhardt, Waltrip, Dick Trickle, and Rick Wilson. And Earnhardt has pretty much had it his way since he passed Darrell, pulling away just very slightly. Dick Trickle, meanwhile, is about almost a half a lap behind the leader. Not quite that, but Trickle is quite a ways behind. There he is, coming there behind Sterling Marlin and ahead of Phil Parsons and Chad Little. About 5.7 seconds behind Dick Trickle is from the leaders. And you can't say enough about Dick Trickle and the performance that he has turned in here and at the other racetracks that he's competed on this year.
The Stavola brothers, Bill and Mickey up in New Jersey, they have got to be just thrilled to death, because when Bobby Allison was injured and was not able to compete, Mike Alexander stepped in, did a great job, and then he had a problem. They had to look for someone else. They found Dick Trickle, and as you said, Bob, enough can't be said for the job he's done in the last 5 or 6 races.
An interesting story about Dick Trickle was the fact that he suffered a badly injured hip in his childhood and spent many, in fact, the press release says 3 years in the hospital trying to get that repaired, and they thought he was going to be permanently injured, but Dick Trickle has certainly overcome that injury. There's the leader, Dale Earnhardt. And there's Richard Petty right behind the leader as he tries to gather up some Winston Cup points.
We saw Jeff Bodine in front of Earnhardt. There he is, the yellow and white number 5. Next week, he's the pole position winner, didn't win. Next week, the ante goes up. 53,200. The guy wins the pole, that can win the race.
Well, that's posted by Unical, $7,600 per race for the pole winner if he wins. And here is Darrell Waltrip in for a pit stop, and Jack Arruda is there.
The Waltrip crew goes to work on the right side. They'll exchange the tires there first, taking all the lug nuts off. Sandy Jones working on the rear tire and the front. Actually, Jones was checking the right side tires. They're only going to change those right sides. In 10.6 seconds, he's away.
Good quick pit stop by Darrell Waltrip as he goes back out onto the racetrack just ahead of Earnhardt.
I tell you, that's amazing that a man can make a pit stop on a half-a-mile racetrack and stay in the lead lap. That was fine pit work by that crew.
And the pressure that it puts on the Richard Childress crew. And here comes Earnhardt down pit road. Now then, has to have 11-second pit stop. Jerry Punch, can he do it?
We'll wait. Pressure is on. Darrell Waltrip now coming out of turn two. It will change left side tires on the Goodrich Chevrolet. Waltrip now hustling down the backstretch into turn three. The Goodrich crew trying, and now the air wrench will fail. The air wrench did fail. They didn't get the left rear tire off. 12.3 seconds, he is down and away. But they did not get to change the left rear tire. The air wrench failed on the left side, and they could not get the left rear tire off, so he only got one tire down.
Well, they came out in front of Darrell Waltrip, Jerry, on the racetrack, but we wonder for the fact that they didn't get that left rear tire on. And it's also interesting that they chose to change left sides. Waltrip changed right sides.
It is indeed, and there you can see now the separation. There is Waltrip putting a lap on the number four car, and Dick Trickle has the lead.
Because Trickle will have a pit stop coming up before too long himself, but he is indeed the leader. He's about half a lap ahead of the Darrell Waltrip and Dale Earnhardt cars.
There he is, the Wisconsin Rapids, Wisconsin driver. And now Waltrip begins to work on Earnhardt.
Yeah, I think those right side tires are going to be a bigger advantage than that left front only that they got on Dale Earnhardt's car.
Tough break that the air wrench would give a problem. But Darrell Waltrip earlier in the day got in behind a malfunction with the jack. And we see Earnhardt slipping off the corner. Waltrip trying to go on the inside. He's trying it down in turn one.
Here comes Darrell. Oh, they go in there side by side. They touch, but it looks like that. The number 17 car is going to come out down the back stretch in pretty good shape. Still running side by side and door handle to door handle with Earnhardt. And now it looks like, yes, Waltrip will pull ahead.
Rick Wilson has just made a pit stop in the Kodak Film Oldsmobile. Rick's been running in the top 10 here all afternoon.
This is not for the lead we mentioned a moment ago. Dick Trickle is still the leader, but Dick Trickle has to make another pit stop.
And that pit stop should be coming up momentarily as 445 laps are completed.
Here comes Ken Schrader out of the pits. Car number 25 pulls right out in front of Darrell Waltrip, but keeps car low on the racetrack. But Dave Marcus is the guy that had to really slow down in the car number 71.
That's what you got to do is just pull right out in the groove. As we mentioned earlier, there's some talk about building an acceleration lane here at Martinsville before too long to allow an easier way in and out of the pits. Now, here is Trickle, and you can see that he's having some handling problems. He needs new tires.
Yeah, that car is really slipping in the turns. He does need some new tires on the car. He'll be coming in pretty shortly, I guess, but right now he's standing out there enjoying the lead.
And this crew is standing on the pit road with the board that says the signals were to stop. They're ready. The man's got the jack in his hands.
Yeah, I wonder if he's getting a signal. Did they have radio contact? Or they might wait now for Sterling Marlin, who's in the pits.
Here he comes
down pit road. Then Sterling Marlin does move out, so that gives him plenty of room. And Jack Arute is right there.
And 47-year-old Dick Trickle brings his car to a halt. Jimmy Fanning, the crew chief, tried to radio him in two laps before, and obviously he didn't get the message. They go to the right side tires. They clean the windshield. They fill the car with fuel. The right front is complete. He runs around, and he is off the way. Trickle is back out on the track.
It was a 12.8-second pit stop for Dick Trickle. Back at Martinsville, Virginia, there are the top five with 462 laps completed. Only three cars are on the lead lap. Waltrip leads. Earnhardt is second. Dick Trickle is third. A lap down in fourth is Rick Wilson. And Terry Labonte is in fifth spot. The Dale Earnhardt car is not running nearly as fast as it did, possibly because of the fact he had the problem with the tires on the most recent pit stop. As you can see, now we'll show the interval between first and second position, and that's how far Earnhardt has dropped off of Darrell Waltrip's pace. Let's go down for a further report to Jerry Punch.
Well, Bob, we saw a week ago where a mechanical failure by brakes cost Alan Kulwicki a chance at winning. Well, today, it was another mechanical failure for Dale Earnhardt. It was an air wrench, and I'll show you what happened here. He is not running well because the left rear tire didn't come off. Here's the air wrench that Will Lynn was trying to use. He brought it back here, took it apart.
and these pieces fell apart. Part of the rotor inside that helps turn this air impact wrench had broken. It would not turn. They could not loosen the lug nut. Therefore, they couldn't change the left rear tire. This little piece here cost about $1.50. May have cost them a chance to win here at Martinsville.
So anything can happen. Not only can something go wrong with the car, but something in the pits that can cost you victory. And of course, we'll never know whether or not Earnhardt's car was capable of pulling off the victory, but it was certainly something in the pits that went wrong. There's the number 11 car of Terry Labonte, and they find themselves in fifth position in the Junior Johnson car. He just came in for a pit stop a few minutes ago, and this is the way that we saw the pit stop from the crew cam. Worn by Mike Hill.
Didn't miss a beat, did he?
Man, that is quick. That is quick.
So a good run by Terry Labonte this afternoon, finding himself in fifth position at the moment. One lap down, however.
If I'm not mistaken, Ned, when the race started, didn't Labonte have problems and drift back?
Yeah, he did. He dropped way back. He started up about fourth position and dropped back to about 20th, eventually went a lap down. But they apparently made some adjustments on the car, and he's stayed only one lap down since then. He's been running good, but he got that lap down, just could never get it back.
Stevie Waltrip watches her husband, Darrell, maintain the lead. With now about 30 laps to go, 470 are complete. Darrell Waltrip looking for his third victory of 1989. He won, of course, the Daytona 500, and he won at Atlanta.
Now we see Harry Gant from the inside in the camera inside Harry Gant's car. And I'll tell you, Harry's lost a cylinder or something. After we talked about him all day and what a great run he's had going, he slowed dramatically in the last 20 or 30 laps, and I think he's on seven cylinders.
Yeah, he is definitely off the pace from what he was running earlier. He's still running pretty decent out there. He's running in what about the 10th position right now, but he's three laps down and just losing time all the time to the leaders.
Waltrip, the winner of the Pannill 500 in 83, in 80, in 78, and in 76. Do you feel like there's no room to maneuver here at Martinsville?
No, it's just two drag strips. You drag down each straightaway, you stop in the middle of both corners, and you drag off the corner and go again. It's just that kind of racetrack. Sometimes you get down so slow, you think you ought to put it in third gear.
Without question, it's one of the most strangely configured racetracks that I've ever seen. Very, very long straightaways and very sharp corners, but it does indeed present some great racing for the fans.
Well, Bob, unlike ball sports where you got a basketball court or a football field that are all the same, or baseball fields are a little bit different, you know, as far as the length of them and how many home runs are hit out of a park and that. Every racetrack is absolutely different from there. There are no two that are alike. In fact, there are not too many similarities, Benny, between them.
No, there isn't. Dover and Rockingham, both one-mile racetracks and totally different racetracks. Rockingham with long straightaways, short corners. Dover, long corners, short straightaways. So everything is different.
And quite a contrast in 2 weeks, as we'll be at the world's fastest speedway, Talladega, for that 500-mile race. We'll be back here at Martinsville after this. Bob Jenkins, Benny Parsons, Ned Jarrett, Jack Arud, and Jerry Punch back at Martinsville. And our field summary will show you that the number 17 car of Darrell Waltrip is the leader of this race. And he has pretty much in control with about a full straightaway length lead on second place Dale Earnhardt. The number 21 car, driven by Neil Bonnet, is right behind our leader, but Neil is several laps down. Behind Neil is the number 40 car, driven by Ben S., one of the rookies in the Winston Cup Series this year.
Ben S. had a good run going today. Several times during the day, he's been as quick as anyone. There's Rick Wilson in the four car. Fourth place car right now. Rick Wilson, good run for him.
And right behind him is the car number six of Mark Martin, who is running in the sixth position. Mark is two laps down.
The number three car of Dale Earnhardt is second, but has quite a lot of ground to make up if he's going to catch the leader.
There we see the 83 car of Lake Speed, the Bullseye Barbecue Sauce Oldsmobile. And right behind him is Alan Kowicki. We talked about Alan Kowicki having a
water pump problem a moment ago, back on the racetrack.
Morgan Shepherd, car number 75, the Valvoline Pontiac is next. And Morgan just hasn't had a good day here today. He won his first Winston Cup race here several years ago, but today that car just hasn't performed for him. And there's Ricky Rudd, who also has had problems. He slammed into the wall. And car number 90 was involved in a wreck earlier, then lost his brakes. He was behind the wall for a while, but back out there running. That's Chad Little.
And then we find the 33 car of Harry Gant, who is four laps down in 13th position, but he has had a struggle all afternoon and performed well, coming from a lap down and then almost another lap down.
Dave Marcus, a Lifebuoy Chevrolet, is running ninth place and started about 30, if I'm not mistaken. Good run for Dave Marcus today. Ken Schrader, the Folger Chevrolet, running seventh. And, you know, the thing is, the first half of the race, Ken Schrader was right there. The last half of the race just simply seems like he hadn't been able to get hold of the racetrack.
Faded away a little bit, and here goes 84, the Dick Prickle car, who's running in third position, about to pass by the car number 25. And right behind them, here comes Phil Parson in the Crown Skull Oldsmobile, car number 55. Phil is currently shown in the 14th position.
The 29 car of Dale Jarrett is shown in 16th spot. He is five laps down to the leader in the newly painted Hardy's Pontiac. And then the pole sitter for this race, Jeff Bodine in car number five. He is 15th, five laps down, involved in an altercation very early in the race.
Terry Labonte in the 11, the Budweiser Ford Thunderbird of Junior Johnson, who's had so much success here at this racetrack, running fifth right now. Good run for Terry.
And the next car in line is Bobby Hillen Jr. Bobby has run all day, but not as good as we've seen him run here in the past. He had a top five finish here last year.
Watch for him at Talladega, though. Of course, he won his only Winston Cup race there in 2 weeks. Now, here's Richard Petty in car number 43. He spent a lot of time behind the wall trying to get that car sorted out, but he is still out there earning Winston Cup points. And here's Sterling Marlin in car number 94. He's had a fairly decent run this afternoon, shown in eighth, two laps down.
And Davey Allison, the last car we've shown now, this will be, we've shown every car that's on the racetrack. And Davey, as we mentioned, problems early on. The fifth or sixth lap of the race, we had a report from the pit that they had a problem.
And that takes us back to the leader of the race, Darrell Waltrip. And he has nine more circuits to go, and he will win the Pannill Sweatshirts 500. And we'll take another break to see if he does win this race when we return here to Martinsville. We're back at Martinsville, where Darrell Waltrip is en route to his 10th victory here at Martinsville Speedway. There are less than seven laps to go. Nine times he has taken the checkered flag here. He has won four Pannill Sweatshirt 500, that is the spring race, and he has won five times in the Goodies 500, the fall race. His most recent victory here at Martinsville was in 1988. So Waltrip trying to win not only his 10th race of the year here at Martinsville, but his third of 1989. And with this victory, Darrell Waltrip is going to pick up some Winston Cup points and find himself right up there in a battle for the Cup.
Yeah, I think he's going to be to contend with before this season is out. There's a lot of them that are going to be to contend with, but he is certainly one of the smartest race drivers on the track. And if he does go into victory here today, it'll be his third of the year, tying Rusty Wallace for the most wins. And, you know, we're not too far into this season.
That's right. You know, when Darrell Waltrip sits in his situation this year, it's been diamonds and stones. He's won three races, and the races that he don't win, he really don't have a very good day. But today, we can't argue, today he's had an excellent day.
Yeah, he saved that race car, ran good, found out at the early part of the race. Everybody else found out, too, that it was a strong race car because he went from 10th position up to 2nd position and has hung right in there in the top five all afternoon and saved the car for the end here. He's done it many times before, knows what it takes to win here, and got himself in that position again.
Just 2.5 more laps, and Darrell Waltrip will be the winner. The Pannill Sweatshirt 500 laps around this half-mile racetrack in Martinsville, Virginia.
And while we're talking about numbers, this will be Darrell's 76th win on the Winston Cup Tour. He is the winningest driver in Winston Cup competition and is about to put another win in his column. He sets the car into the third and fourth turns now.
comes out of the fourth turn and receives the white flag from Harold Kinder. One more lap to go in the half mile here at Martinsville. There are essentially no other battles on the racetrack to show you, so we're going to show you Darrell Waltrip's final lap. He comes down the backstretch halfway around on the final time. Now into turn three and in turn four, where Jeff Bodine was taken out in the early race. Here comes Waltrip off the fourth corner. His hand is in the air, waving to the crowd, and Darrell Waltrip has won the Pannill Sweatshirts 500 here at Martinsville. And the Thai crew is in celebration in victory in the pit area. Let's go to Jerry Punch.
Well, Jeff Hammond here, the Tide crew celebrating in on pit road as they are happy another win here at Martinsville Speedway. As Jeff Hammond, Jeff, congratulations. You guys had the car dialed in all day long.
I'll tell you what, Jerry, it's just been, the car's worked so good the last couple, three races. I mean, it's just, you know, it's just been our time. It's just, you know, we just finally got everything to go together like we needed to. Bristol, we were a couple laps short. Last week at Wilkesboro, we were really running good and had some motor problems, but today everything went great. My hat's off to the Hendrick Motorsports engine department. They've done a great job today. Randy and all the guys back at the shop. I mean, you know, heck fire. We're having the luck we need this year. And the pit stop, we were able to, I think, force Earnhardt's hand and had a little bit of a problem. And it just paid off our way all, you know, today. I mean, it's just been a great day.
Truly a team effort for the Tide crew as Darrell Waltrip picks up his 10th career win here, winning the Pannill Sweatshirts 500 as an exuberant Tide crew heads over to victory lane. Bob?
And the third win of the 1989 season for Darrell Waltrip. His margin of victory was 6.79 seconds over the second place finishing car of Dale Earnhardt. Our Speed World coverage of the Pannill Sweatshirts 500 has been brought to you by Quaker State Motor Oil. The big Q stands for quality, always has, always will. By Buick and your Buick dealer, the Great American Road belongs to Buick. By Armor All Protectant, because we're crazy about cars too. And by the Big A, the first letter in auto parts, and your local Big A store. And so we'll go to Victory Lane next to talk with Darrell Waltrip, who has won this Winston Cup race here this afternoon. Darrell Waltrip is in Victory Lane, and so is our Jackaroot as we go down for the Winner's Circle interview being brought to you by America's best-selling replacement battery, the Sears Diehard. Take it away, Jack.
And Bob, if you don't think that 500 laps here at Martinsville will wear a driver out, Darrell Waltrip just got out of the car, stood on the roof, and slid down the windshield, getting the congratulations of Jeff Hammond. Darrell, it's not Daytona, it's not Atlanta. Is he going to take a little oxygen here? But it is Martinsville. You did a heck of a job today, bud.
Well, I'm just thankful. I want to praise God, and I mean that from the bottom of my heart. What a day it was for us, and the car just did good. And Tide and Exxon and AC spark plugs and Goodyear tires. Jackie, I can't tell you what they mean to this program and to this sport. And they came through for me today, and I'm really appreciative.
Hey, there were a couple of close calls on pit road for you guys, too. The jack failed, and you almost pulled out of pit road with the left sides without any lug nuts. But you showed the maturity. You stayed there, and you kept it going. Yes, here, well, let's bring in Jessica Lee in here. She wants to get the congratulations. He's going to take some oxygen, and I tell you, he's worn out. We're going to let him get the congratulations of Stevie, his wife, and Jessica Lee. Getting the kiss, and I think this says just about everything that needs to be said about Victory Lane here for Darrell Waltrip today.
It is a tough race, but Darrell Waltrip has withstood the rigors and come home the victory in the Pannill Sweatshirts 500. The top 10 finishers following Waltrip to the checkered flag, Dale Earnhardt. In third was Dick Trickle, fourth Rick Wilson, and fifth was Terry Labonte. Finishing 6 through 10, Mark Martin, Ken Schrader, Sterling Marlin, Dave Marcus, and Davey Allison, and Earnhardt maintains the points lead with Bodine second. Coming up at midnight tonight here on ESPN, the San Marino Grand Prix, as Formula One coverage continues here on ESPN. For Ned Jarrett, Benny Parsons, Jack Arute, and Jerry Punch, this is Bob Jenkins. So long, everyone.